Java, in Indonesia. It is the world's most populated island, populated not just by anyone, but some of the friendliest people you'll ever meet. And the Javanese, they love to eat. It's not only the Javanese who inhabit this incredible island, but also the Sundanese, Betawi, and more. We will explore their cuisine from the narrow alley street food of Bandung to the countryside cooked meals in the Kingdom of Yogyakarta. The diversity of food on this one island is enough to have a lifetime of culinary discoveries. This is a film about three trips that I've taken recently to Java to experience the island's food and its heritage. Over 100 hours spent filming, compiled into an extensive, but certainly not exhaustive, documentary about the food treasures of Java. We're kicking things off with some sidewalk sate for breakfast in the capital of West Java, Bandung. Okay, first stop here in Bandung is for sate. This is a super popular sate stall, and you can just spot it from a mile down the street because of the smoke coming off of this thing. So there's a big line of people, and they're serving sate, different cuts of meat. They're just grilling up some chunks of fat, chicken and beef fat, and they've got this thing going with a big flame, really charring the outside of that fat, and it doesn't take long to cook. Lots of flames. It's not really the charcoal normal sauté that you would normally see. They really got a fire going there and grilling those and charring them up. So it's going to be super smoky, and I am ready to taste my first taste of famous Bandung street food here at this little sauté stall.
Chicken and beef.
Chicken and beef. So after being grilled, the satay are served on a bed of lontong, which is like a compressed rice, and then topped with so much sauce. They put that peanut sauce, that satay peanut sauce, and then a little bit of ketchup manis, the sweet soy sauce, and then you can get the spicy sambal on it as well. And this is the final product served in, on this bed of banana leaf, and it is absolutely a saucy mess. So there's some lontong down there. This cut right here is really unique. This is the cow udder. So I don't think I've ever tried udder before. This one's chicken, and then we've got some regular beef over there, and then the lontong down at the bottom. I think I gotta go in for the udder first and get lots of that sauce. Look at that, wow. Whoa, that just dissolves into a liquid. It basically tastes like fat. A little bit of a chewiness to it, and the sauce. A little bit spicy, a little bit sweet, super nutty and peanutty, and then chase it with one of these lontong. Whoa, first time trying udder. That lontong just gives it a little bit of a sustenance, makes it a real meal. I love how generous they went with the sauce. There's so much sauce in there. I'm gonna try the chicken this time. Oh wow. It's all about the sauce. There's a couple pieces of the peanuts that haven't been ground up, so it's got a little bit of a crunch to it too. Last but not least, the beef. Oh man. I love it. So good. So smoky. That is phenomenal saute. Really popular stall right on the street, sitting on tiny little stool. Love the atmosphere here in Bandung. Look at how packed this place is. Super, super busy. And the saute are amazing. Worth the wait. And this is just stop one of many here in Bandung. There's so many foods to try here. This is my next stop here. It's called mie kocok dadeng, and mie kocok is a noodle dish that you can really only have here in Bandung. It's served with beef, and kocok means to shake the noodles. I don't really know anything else than that, so I'm gonna go inside and see how they prepare the mie kocok.
And noodles.
Yeah, okay. And noodles and bean sprout.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Lock in.
Okay. Good job.
This. Okay. Stop in.
Wow.
Good.
Nice.
Coffee.
Thank you. So I'm back here with the chef. He's just showing me how to make the mi kochok. So I saw him kind of mixing kochok, mixing it with the soup. And it's the cartilage, the skin, and beef meat. You can get it with mi noodles or just soup. This place is absolutely bonkers, super packed out, really local, homey restaurant, almost like a street food stall, but it is a restaurant, and it's absolutely crazy in here. I'm waiting for a seat, and hopefully I'll be able to take one soon. So here in West Java, it's commonplace to serve unsweetened hot tea called ante. So they've given us the tea. I'm sitting down at the restaurant now. I only had to wait about 5 minutes. They also brought over a bag of this here, which is the keropok. It's pink from just food coloring, but it's a tapioca cracker that's meant to be also eaten with the mi kochok. Yeah, not sweet. My mi kochok has arrived. Look at that big chunk of bone marrow. We ordered the special, so it comes with a big chunk of bone marrow. There is cartilage and skin, there's pieces of beef in there, and then all in this beautiful noodle with some bean sprouts on the bottom. And you definitely have to dress this, season it up. So there's some sambal here, some chili sauce. Go for a nice healthy scoop of that. And then also some kaffir lime here. Go for a squeeze and then give that a mix. Oh man, beautiful, beautiful looking bowl of noodles, and this chunk of bone marrow is calling my name, but I gotta try the noodles first. That is really beefy, and that kaffir lime leaves gives it such a nice aroma, and those noodles perfectly cooked. It's a pretty simple bowl, but super satisfying. Home cooked flavor, yum. I gotta cut this piece in half because I want to savor it and have it at least for two bites. It's like butter. Oh man. That broth is such a rich, a little bit salty, but really rich, beefy flavor. And that is seriously like butter. I'm going to open this up and try one of the keropok. Super crunchy tapioca crackers. And just look at the design of that. Really unique. There you go for a little dip in the soup. Oh man, this is satisfying. It's a really nice contrast of textures with the keropok because super crunchy, and then everything in here is really soft. I'm gonna try to get a piece of the skin you can see there with some of the noodles. Solid bowl of noodles. This place is absolutely crazy. A local favorite here in Bandung. This is a culinary city, and they know how to eat. They know good food, and these mi kochok are great. Terima kasih. Terima kasih.
Brother.
Thank you.
People are so friendly here. I'm specifically trying to eat light because I want to taste as much as I can here in Bandung. And just look at this. There's street food right in front. I'm gonna skip this though and head to another famous spot.
Okay.
So I've come bright and early to this extremely popular stall that's selling something called kupat tahu. This is such a popular stall. There's a massive line of grab food drivers picking up for delivery, and then just tons of hungry customers. So they're serving kupat tahu, which is a rice cake or compressed rice, so ketupat, but here they call it kupat. And tahu, which is tofu. So she takes the compressed rice, slices it up into little small bite-sized pieces, and then does the same with some fried tofu. And then it's topped with just a ton of peanut sauce, completely smothered in peanut sauce, a little bit of ketchup manis, the sweet soy sauce, and then some fried shallots, and then some keropok, the shrimp crackers. And this is really popular for breakfast. You can just see there's so many people here. So I'm gonna go inside and try out the kupat tahu. So it's quite a simple dish, as I mentioned, just the tofu, the kupat, the compressed rice cakes, and then there is a couple bean sprouts on there slathered in that peanut sauce, and then some ketchup manis, and then topped with this huge keropok. And this tofu is quite special. It comes from a place called Chibuntu. It's a town that's nearby to Bandung that's extremely famous for its quality of tofu, because the water quality there is really good. So they're using Chibuntu tofu here. So I'm gonna go in for a bite. I've got chopsticks here because they ran out of forks and spoons. So I'm gonna try a bite with a piece of the rice cake, if I can find one, and a piece of the tofu. Oh wow. I thought it was gonna be served cold, but actually the tofu is still nice and hot. So is the kupat. Even the sauce on top, I think, was a little bit hot. It's got a really nutty, nutty flavor and a little bit of a sweetness too. There's a sambal on the table here, so I'm gonna add some spice, even though it's only like 7 a.m., a little bit of a pick-me-up. Try that with some of that tofu. Yeah, you can tell that tofu is really, really good quality. Yum. Mm-hmm. A little bit spicy, but that is a perfect breakfast dish. It's really light. The flavor is not super strong. It kind of looks like it's gado gado, but it's not at all. The flavor is totally different. I love that peanut sauce. Super thick, creamy, and rich. Like peanut butter toast, Indonesia style. This place is super popular for a reason. It's all about the sauce, and the tofu quality is just so good. I really, really love this sauce. It's got a sweetness, nuttiness. It's perfect for breakfast. And actually, I tried to come here yesterday, and I came around 10 o'clock, and they were already sold out 10 a.m. So this place sells out really quick. If you wanna get here and try it, you gotta come early. Maybe not your typical breakfast of fried tofu and compressed rice, but I will have to say that it definitely works for breakfast, and it's actually quite normal for a Western palate because the sauce is so sweet and peanutty, and I used to eat a lot of peanut butter toast for breakfast. It's kind of like a different version of that. But we're gonna keep going and taste more of what Bandung has to offer. So my next stop today is at a legendary stall called Mi Baso Gagak. They're selling bakmi. So I ordered both the dry version and the soup version. It's a Chinese influenced noodle, but very Indonesian. And this restaurant is just really homey feeling, super hidden, hole in the wall type atmosphere. My noodles have arrived. This is the first one. This is the mi baso. So it's the soup version. It's got shredded chicken all over top. There's a couple of spring onions in there, and this beautiful
noodles, give it a little bit of a mix, a lot of shredded chicken. And I ordered this with the special, so it comes with a side of all kinds of different things over here. So there is the baso, the meatballs, beef balls, beef tripe. You can see that kind of creepy looking tripe. And then there's some dumplings in there too. And then back here is the yamien, which is the dry version of the same dish, but it's just dried. So you can get the sweet and salty. I ordered the salty version. I'm gonna give that a little bit of a mix too. And there's also some beautiful sambal on the table. Look at the color of that. It's just super rich, right? I'm gonna put it in my soup. Yeah, go for one more scoop. Let's try it out. The noodles are very soft. That sambal has some vinegar in it, so it's got some acidity. Okay, I'm gonna try the yamien now, the dry noodles, and you can load this sambal. It's really, really good. A little bit of vinegar in there. You mix that up. Oh yeah, look at that. Most of the flavor is coming from that sambal. It's got a little bit of a spice, but it's mostly vinegar. I'm gonna chase it with one of these dumplings. It's not as firm as like Chinese noodles usually are, or Japanese noodles are really soft. Yeah. Very satisfying, hearty bowl of noodles, cool atmosphere. Simple but satisfying bowl of noodles. This is the type of restaurant I wouldn't be surprised if I was the only foreigner or Westerner who's ever been here.
Enak pokoknya. Aduh, ini bahasa goreng ini hauce itu simping enak nih. Ya, harga satunya banget 11.000.
Oh. Hauce. Oh, enak.
Iya. Bentar gore mau beras. Setiap hari bukanya dari jam 7.30 sampai jam 10. Satu aja sih.
Jaki 5.
The next food I'm trying today in Bandung is bakso goreng. So bakso is meatballs and goreng is fried. So this fellow here is making the fried meatballs. So you can see he's making it right here with this mixture. It's half chicken and half mackerel. And it's like super, super sloppy, goopy mixture. And then he's dumping it in the oil back over here. You can see they've got like 1, 2, 3, 4 different pots of the hot oil here, and they're just overflowing with the bakso. It's really greasy looking, but it's meant to be eaten with sambal, so spicy sauce. And just check this out, look at how many meatballs they've got going at once here.
And they've also kind of sliced them into kind of to open them up and cook them in the middle, and then as they keep frying, they flour open. Look at all that. Wow, nice. Bakso goreng.
Bakso goreng, enak, lucu.
Enak?
Enak, lucu. Lucu, si timbing, enak gila, aduh. Oh, berpaya jarang.
Alright,
well, let's try out some bakso goreng. The street food just never stops here in Bandung. This is the final result, the bakso goreng fried meatballs. You can see, like we saw, they were cutting them open and now they've kind of floured open like this, bloomed, if you will. And they're actually really light. They feel really airy. I'm gonna put it down here and break off one of these chunks. Super crispy feeling. It feels really, really crispy. And like I said, it's half mackerel, half chicken. And there's a beautiful sambal on the table. So you gotta generously
go for a dip in this because otherwise it's just gonna be fried flavor, not much to it. Let's try this out.
Mm.
Really airy. It's very light. Feels like almost like youtiao or fried bread because it's so airy on the inside. There's lots of air bubbles. And then the sambal is quite spicy. Garlic in there for sure. Super, super crispy too. I like the texture. We go good with the beer, to be honest. This sambal is hot, definitely got some heat to it. And it's honestly like a meat donut is how I describe it. It's fried like a donut. The texture is almost like a donut, but it's a little bit fish flavor and chicken. So it's like a meat donut almost. Okay, so airy.
Yep. Cool spot right underneath a stadium bleachers on the backside of the stadium, actually. Quite greasy, but definitely tasty, especially with that sambal. I am at the next stop for our food tour here in Bandung today, and this place is called Ayam Goreng Nikmat, and it's a fried chicken style. They're frying chicken using charcoal to heat the oil, which I actually have never seen before, to use the charcoal just to deep fry something. And that oil has been infused with lemongrass. So at the beginning of the day, they put a bunch of lemongrass in the oil. And they have kampung chicken, so village chicken, free range chicken. They also have a bunch of other different things fried, and it's eaten with veggies and lots of fresh stuff. They also fry cabbage, which is something really interesting, taking something healthy and then just making it completely unhealthy. It almost turns into like a chip. One of the vegetables to eat with the fried chicken is this, the pate, stink beans, the infamous stink beans. They have a really strong aroma. I'm gonna definitely order some of those up to have with my ayam goreng. Here in West Java, the main tribe are the Sundanese people. So this is kind of like Sundanese style fried chicken. I've got my fried chicken right here, cooked on that charcoal heated lemongrass infused oil. And you can see, this is what a real chicken's supposed to look like, people. That is a chicken leg. This is a village chicken free range. None of that steroid stuff. Just really thin meat on there. Served with this red hot looking sambal. And you're supposed to squeeze this lime in there, get that lime juice in there, mixed with that really red sambal. And then the West Java people, the Sundanese people, they really like to eat with raw veggies. So we got cucumber, raw cabbage, eggplant. This is lemon basil. There's some lettuce back there. And then also the quintessential tea served on every table here in West Java. And then this is a type of rice called nasi timbul. It's rolled up inside of this banana leaf here, and you can only find this in West Java. So you're supposed to pull it like this, almost like a Christmas cracker, open it up, and then release the aroma. And look at that, it's like a log of rice. Wow, so cool. Oh yeah, you can smell it. Oh, it smells so good. And then this is the fried cabbage, which I thought was gonna be served crispy, but it's actually soggy and super oily. And then the pad thai, the grilled stink beans. So really grilled, charred up there. And then this is all meant to just be eaten together with the fried chicken and with your hands. So let's dig in. I love the aroma of the lemongrass oil. Nice piece of chicken there. Go for a generous dip in that. That is like blood red sambal. And then put it on my rice, and I'm gonna grab some of these veggies too. I'll go for some lemon basil here, and maybe a little slice of cucumber as well. And then just go in with your hands, grab some rice, grab some chicken, try that. Oh wow. There's more food being served. Man, that sambal is incredible. Get that fresh lemon herb. The rice also has an aroma of the banana leaf. Well, the chicken's not very crispy, but it's got a really nice flavor. So this salad that I just brought out is a West Java salad made with a special type of ginger called kanchur. And there's karobok, the little crispy crackers there. Put this back on my rice too. And go right in with my fingers here with some of that. Mm. It's actually quite sweet and got a lot of heat to it, but this chicken is really what the restaurant is famous for. Really yummy. A little bit of sambal too. Let me try out this fried cabbage now, just by itself. Yeah, there's nothing to it, but chase it with one of these. That sambal is incredible. And let me try to dig out one of these guys, the infamous stink beans. So you can see on the inside, there we go. So these have been grilled right in the casing. And again, dip that in the sambal to help calm the stink down. It's such a unique flavor. It's really strong. It completely dominates the bite, and it coats your mouth in this really raunchy aroma.
It only takes one stink bean to stay in your mouth all day long. Slight regret because that flavor is not leaving until I brush my teeth at least 3 times, but really good fried chicken, and it does go nicely with it. So this is Ibu Imas, easily one of the most popular restaurants here in Bandung. It has over 15,000 reviews on Google Reviews, so they're serving Sundanese food, which is the food to try here in Bandung. Very, very famous restaurant. Might be one of the most reviewed restaurants I've ever seen. So I'm gonna go inside, order up a big Sundanese feast for lunch today. Ibu Imas is particularly famous for their grilled chicken, their Sundanese grilled chicken. So we tried the Sundanese fried chicken, and now it's time to try the grilled version. You can see that it's glowing yellow. It's probably been marinated with some turmeric, different spices, and he's basting it with this paintbrush with a dark sauce, probably ketchup manis. There's some spices in there for sure. And cooking on charcoal. It's looking really, really good. Starting to caramelize that sauce on the outside. Let's go try out some Sundanese grilled chicken and some more dishes, of course, too. I'm sitting down now, and before you even order, there's already a couple things on the table. So right here, we've got just a basic looking sambal, and then this one is a lemon basil sambal. So you can see those lemon basil leaves in there, and then there's these little tiny pea eggplants, and they're quite popular here at Ibu Imas for their sambal. And then we've also got a tray of different veggies and herbs, and then I just got my rice, but I've also ordered a ton of different things that are meant to be eaten with the different things that are already on the table when you arrive. The ayam bakar, or grilled chicken, has arrived. You can see all that sauce caramelized on the outside, served with some limes, and you can see the little charred bits from the charcoal as well. And then I've got a couple little things back here. This is called pepas. It's a mushroom that's wrapped up in this leaf here, and then fried tofu and fried tempeh, the soybean cake. And then over here I've got a tamarind soup with all kinds of different things in there. There's corn, there's chayote, there's melinjo, and there's peanuts in there, and it's all in like a tamarind base broth. This looks so good, so let's dig in. I'm gonna go straight in for some of this grilled chicken. Grab a big chunk, and still really hot. Look at all that sauce on the skin there. And then I definitely gotta go in for
some of this lemon basil sambal, which is really cool, really popular here at Ibu Imas, and then of course meant to be eaten with your hands. So let me go in, get a little bit of that sambal, some of that grilled chicken, some rice. Mmm. Whoa. That's a flavor bomb. I love the lemon basil. It's got a really citrusy lemon flavor. The chicken is nice and sweet, actually. Let me grab a piece of the chicken just by itself. Try it by itself because that sambal is quite overpowering. Yeah. It tastes like a honey garlic grilled chicken is what it tastes exactly like. Really tender chicken too. Mm. Oh, that's great. I'm gonna try their second sambal on offer here at Ibu Imas. Grab a nice spoonful there, and then I'm gonna grab this little guy here, which is stuffed with mushrooms. You can get different things inside, but this one's with mushrooms. Try to open it up. Okay, yeah, you can see, oh wow, look at that. Oh, it's nice and hot still. So I'll grab a little bit of this mushroom peppers. That sambal is much spicier than the lemon basil, but I love those mushrooms. This soup looks pretty interesting. I'm gonna grab some of the chayote, some peanuts in there, try it with some of the broth. Mmm. Whoa. Not what I was expecting at all. It's really sweet. That soup, I thought it was gonna be salty and maybe sour, but it's actually very sweet. Almost tastes like they put sugar in it. They probably did, but it's quite sweet. I really like that grilled chicken the most though. Definitely this grilled chicken is why this place is famous. It's just so good, that marinade and that mix of sauce that they put on the outside, and then get it with some of this lemon basil sambal. It just works so well. Mm-hmm. The sambal, really powerful flavor of lemon basil and shrimp paste. Yum.
Phenomenal grilled chicken. Really sweet in my opinion. I wasn't expecting that, but I guess Sundanese food is sweet. This place is so famous. It's absolutely packed. You can also sit counter side. So I'm gonna take a little bit of a break, and then this evening hit the streets of Bandung and do some more eating. It is nighttime now here in Bandung, and just like any good food city, it really comes to life at nighttime. Temperature is a little bit cooler, people are hungry, and I am heading to try some more specialties here in Bandung. And the first place I'm going is selling something quite interesting. This is the stall I was looking for. It's selling suike, which is frogs. So it specializes in frog dishes. They serve, in particular, two dishes that I want to try. The first is deep fried frog legs, and the second is a fermented soybean paste broth that frog legs are blanched in and then served almost like a soup. So really unique. I've definitely never tried frog legs here in Indonesia. I didn't know it was popular, but apparently here in Bandung, it is quite a popular dish. The stall is definitely packed out with locals. So I'm gonna order up those two dishes, the deep fried frog legs, and then the soybean paste, fermented soybean paste frog legs. So he's got a big pot of the bubbling fermented soybean. It really smells good. It smells almost like cheese. And those frog legs are just boiling in there. And then it's just served in that broth. So it's very simple. And then the fried frog legs are breaded and then deep fried in oil. But wow, that bubbling broth smells good.
this stall is really hardcore. This is the definition of street food. This is a sidewalk during the daytime. They just put up a couple tarps, which block the fumes from the car, and then they're cooking right on the sidewalk, and they just have one table that's completely packed with locals.
Here are the deep fried frog legs. Look at that batter, looking super crispy. Honestly reminds me of like tempura. And I'm gonna take a little bit of lime here and squeeze it on. That feels super, super crunchy. Wow, deep fried frog legs on the streets of Indonesia.
Like chicken.
That's what everyone says about frog, right? It really does. It tastes like halfway between chicken and fish, like a white fish. That batter, super crunchy, crispy. It's like a tempura and salted nicely, and then with a little bit of sourness from that lime. Yum. That's good, but I want to try the other dish out, the soybean one. Yum. I like that.
I know it's a cliche thing to say, but it really does taste like chicken. And I honestly think I prefer this over the fried chicken that I had earlier today. It's really tasty. Mm.
There's little bones, but the meat is so tender. And it's super crunchy. Yeah.
So this is the fermented soybean broth frog soup called suike kua. You can see they really go generous with the frog legs in there, plump little frog thighs. And I'm gonna dress this up with a little bit of lime. So grab some lime here, give it some sourness, and that broth, like I said earlier, it really smells cheesy. You can smell that fermented scent. And then there's some chili on the table too. Grab some of this raw chili, look at that. That looks spicy. I'll go a little bit easy on that. Throw that in there, give it a little mix. Yeah, that's looking good. A little bit of extra broth. And let me try that. My frog leg soup experience is elevated with some ukulele music. Let's try. It's got a really tangy fermented flavor. The frog legs have soaked up that fermented soybean flavor. You can taste the acidity from the lemon again. But it's a really unique texture when it's not fried. It's more firm than before. Before it kind of felt like a white fish, but now it's like something totally different. I've got another bite here with lots of meat, and I'm just gonna saturate that in the broth. That broth is very unique. It's kind of strange, to be honest. But with the rice, it does work. I like the deep fried frog legs better, to be honest. I'm just gonna try some of the broth by itself. Ooh. Yeah, it's got a little bit of a bitterness to it too, actually. The frog flavor is non-existent. It's just overpowered by that fermented soybean. Usually when I think about eating frog legs, what would first come to mind would be some kind of like fine dining or something in France, but now my perception has completely changed. I'm gonna be thinking about the streets of Bandung the next time I think about eating frog legs. And the word suike is Hokkien Chinese for water chicken or frog. So pretty unique dish. I definitely recommend trying it out. And it's definitely time for dessert after a long day of eating.
A big one, right?
So just down the street from the Frog Leg stall, there is a place that's very popular called Ronde Jahe. And they're selling two desserts, two very Indonesian with Chinese influence desserts. So I've got them both here. The first is this tahu. And it's basically just tofu, but in Taiwan, I would call this dohua. So it's served with a gula broth, the sweet broth, with a very silken tofu. And then over here, this is the ronde. So these little balls stuffed with crushed peanuts. He rolls them up in rice flour. And then again, it's served in this sweet broth. And this broth has ginger in it. So it's got like a spice to it. You can really smell that ginger. I think I gotta go for the dohua first. That's not the local name, but that's just how I know it. Look at this texture of that tofu. Get lots of that ginger broth. That is like concentrated ginger flavor. Super spicy from the ginger. It's all about that broth, wow. Woo, it stings on the way down. So they got pink ones and green ones and white ones, but the filling's the same. So I'll just grab this one here, try it out. Stuff with crushed peanuts. It's got like a mochi texture. And then the peanuts are not as smooth as they serve this dish in Taiwan. It's more of a crunchy peanut on the inside. This place has got to be famous because of that broth. That's so potent. Seriously potent ginger broth. I love it. Yum. I gotta give it up for the ronde though. Look at that little ball of goodness. That rich brown ginger broth. That'll wake you up or put you to sleep. That was dessert number one, and moving on to dessert number two. There is just so much street food here in Bandung. The streets are just lined. It is just a constant street food. Oh, red pork. Yeah, there is a lot of Chinese influence here as well, so you can get some pork dishes. Fried rice right up here, it looks like. Wow, there's so much. For my second dessert this evening in Bandung, I've come for martabak manis, the deadliest dessert in Indonesia. These things are seriously calorie heavy. Basically, it's a huge pancake that is coated in butter, and then you can order a mix of different toppings. My preferred topping is chocolate with cheese and condensed milk. And this is like an assembly line of martabaks here. You can get the thick kind, which I'm going to order, or you can also get like a thin, crispy one. So, oh man, I'm gonna have to hit the gym after this. You really should go to the gym at least for 1 hour after eating a martabak manis if you want to save your life. The amount of butter, well, I think it's actually margarine in one of these martabak manis, could stop a small child's heart. Okay, our martabak manis has been finished cooking, and this thing weighs like at least a kg, if not more. Let's do the unboxing. Oh man, oh man. So after it's finished cooking, they put the cheese down, and then they put a couple chocolate sprinkles down, and then cover it, douse it in condensed milk, and then flip it, close it, and then put more margarine on the outside, which is insane because they already put so much margarine. Oh, it's really, really hot, and look it. I just touched it for 1 second and my fingers are covered in butter.
And you can see that it's kind of like porous, those like bubbles in the batter, because it's actually a fermented batter. So for all you people thinking right now, cheese and chocolate don't go together, well, you're wrong. You need to try it if you've never tried it before, because it's delicious. I feel guilty eating this. It's like a sin. It's really deadly, guys. Like, there's gotta be tens of thousands of calories in one of these. I don't even know. Mm-hmm. It's so good. It's so good. That is the definition of ugly delicious. Nothing pretty about this, folks. Nothing pretty about it. But damn, it's good. So I've hit the streets again of Bandung. It's the evening time now, and I've come to try one of the most famous things to eat here in Bandung. It's called batagor. So it stands for ba, which means bakso, the meatball, ta, which stands for tahu, the tofu, and gor, which stands for goreng. So fried meat, tofu ball, fried tofu ball, I guess. And it's more of like a dumpling, I guess you could say. And this place, batagor abui, is quite famous for their batagor, so I'm gonna try it out. So this place is kind of in a shed or like a garage right on the side of the street, and this is Bandung original food, the batagor, and I've got my serving here. So it's actually also mixed with some mackerel, similar to the bakso goreng that we had earlier today. There's also, it looks like, some green onions in there, scallions, and then their sauce looks incredible. They start with a sambal, and then they squeeze a lime in there, and then add a little bit of the ketchup manis. And you can see, look at how much sauce they give you. So I think these are meant to be completely drowned in it. Hopefully that's not too crazy spicy. That's good. It's not too spicy at all. It's actually quite sweet. You can really taste that sweet soy sauce. And the texture of these, totally different than the bakso goreng. These are much chewier, bouncier. You can feel that there's some tofu mix in there. And that sauce is really what this is all about. Look at that. There's drowning in it. Yum. Now, these don't really look like much, but these are seriously good, actually. A lot better than the bakso goreng, in my opinion. I could sit and eat this whole plate, and the bakso goreng were a little bit too greasy for me. These aren't as crunchy on the outside either. They're really bouncy and chewy a little bit. I don't know what it is about these, but they are actually really good. I wasn't expecting much because it doesn't look like much. Yeah, they're really yummy. Wow, that was surprisingly delicious. I love batagor, and Bandung is one of those cities that really comes to life at nighttime, especially for food. So I'm gonna go and try some of the popular desserts to try here in Bandung. Let's go. So I've come now to the night market here in Bandung. It's called Cibadak. It's absolute street food galore. The streets are just lined with stalls selling all kinds of different things. Not just Bandung specialties, but also food from around Indonesia. So I'm looking for a very famous dessert though that is particular to Bandung. It's called surabi. This is the surabi. It's a fermented rice batter with coconut, and then I ordered mine with kinja, which is all this palm sugar you can see right there. It's just completely smothered in it. This is a dessert, so I'm gonna cut off a small bite, expecting it's gonna be quite sweet. Oh wow, it's really, really dense actually. I can barely get my spoon through it. Oh my gosh, it's really, really dense. All right, let's try that.
Mmm. Oh, it's actually, it's not crazy sweet. It reminds me exactly of a palm in India. It's got that tangy fermented rice flavor, but it's a nice balance with coconut and sweetness, and it's a really dense cake. I love the palm sugar. It tastes really, really good and fresh. Mmm. That's really good. Yum. So Robbie, look at it, it's so heavy. I'm just gonna break my spoon. Wow. It's good.
Not a bad dessert, probably not the best version of it in Bandung, but sarabi, worth a try. And this street is just bonkers. People here like to eat and eat late. It's getting late and it's still just so packed with people. I'm going for one more dessert though. So I've come to this place now called Roti Bakar 234. They're selling roti bakar, which is toast, but they do it here on charcoal by hand. You can order all kinds of different fillings. I think I'm gonna go with something with chocolate. It's quite a hardcore setup, a really shady alley, a little sketchy looking with these bars right here, almost like a jail cell, and then a little tiny stall, but there's lots of locals here, and they're doing it the traditional way on charcoal by hand, so I'm excited to try it out. I got my favorite mixture of cheese, chocolate, and condensed milk, and to say that they are generous with the portion size is an understatement. You get an entire loaf of bread. He cuts it into four slices and then slathers it with butter, and then opens up the little cheese drawer that he's got with some slices of cheese, lays down some cheese, and then lays down some chocolate sprinkles on top of that, and then tons of condensed milk, and that's on each piece of the bread, and then it goes right onto the charcoal to be grilled up until that cheese and that chocolate gets right melty and delicious. Man, oh man, I'm really getting my calorie intake here in Bandung, wow. Okay, here is the final result, the roti bakar, similar to the martabak that I had yesterday. At least I got the same ingredients, but this one's with the thick bread. Look at that, an entire loaf of bread, and you can see the charcoal grill on there. I'm gonna go for a piece from the middle if I can. Oh, they're huge. Oh yeah, here we go. Oh, I think I took two. Look at that, chocolatey, cheesy, all that condensed milk. Let me try this out. Whoa, that's sweet, super sweet. The chocolate didn't melt as much as in the martabak, and it's really smoky, like you can taste that grill, a little bit bitter almost. Same with the cheese, didn't really melt too much. I think I prefer martabak, but it's still pretty good. Man, that thing is deadly. I can only have one piece of this tonight. Oh wow. What a setting too. Down this super sketchy little alley. You taste the grill. I've got a fan right here. No man.
Say hello.
Hello.
Alright, this woman is selling the first snack of the day. It's called chabuk rambak, and it's basically ketupat, which is a compressed rice cake with a sesame dressing with kaffir lime leaf
in the dressing. So that is the special sauce that goes on top of the rice cake, and then it's eaten with a cracker. And she's just set up right on the floor of the market once you enter. And I think this one's mine.
This is the final result. Pretty simple, but apparently this is a solo only dish. Well, really hard to find outside of solo. Serve with the rice crackers on the side on top of this banana leaf here. Let's try one out. I think it's gonna be all about that dressing. All the flavor is gonna be coming from that. Mm. Oh, wow. That's a little flavor bomb. Oh, that's awesome. It's really nutty from the sesame and strong kaffir lime flavor. It's not like a normal lime. If you've never had kaffir lime, it's more of like a aromatic lemon lime flavor, but without the sourness. And it's kind of still got a texture to it, like the sesame, or maybe there's also some peanut in there. It's a little bit granular. Let's go for one more. Oh, that's actually really good. And the ketupat has got a nice soft texture. No flavor in that rice cake. All the flavor from that sauce. Let's try this. It's like a little Rice Krispie. It's simple, but yum. It's really good. Kind of reminds me a little bit of gado gado, the sauce anyway, but I've never had something quite tasting like that. The really strong kaffir lime leaf flavor, and this market is craziness. So, gonna keep walking through and see what else we can find here at the Solo Market. This market is super tight quarters, but we've just come to the next stall. Is this one, and they've got a huge line. I don't know if you can see behind me. And they're selling ice dawet, which is kind of like cendol. It's a dessert, so we'll try it out. It's really popular. Enough to grab one of the only seats here. There's just one bench. Ari and I are sitting here, and there's quite a few ingredients in it. So first she puts the green cendol noodles, and then a little bit of black rice, and then some rice pudding, and then sugar syrup, coconut water, some basil seeds, and then coconut milk and ice, of course. So it is super popular. I mean, the locals are just eating this up like crazy. I'm excited to try it out. And here is my bowl. You can see all those ingredients floating around in there, the black rice. You can see those basil seeds, a couple pieces of ice, and that is the rice pudding right there. But let me try to get some of those green noodles. Try those. Wow, it's actually leaning more on the savory side than I was expecting. There's a little bit of saltiness in there, but it's balanced nicely with sweetness. That has such a crazy flavor. I was not expecting it. It's kind of floral. I'm not exactly sure where that flavor is coming from. But you get all the contrasting textures too, the little crunchy basil seeds, the kind of chewies in there, and then the creamy coconut milk. And there's a really nice strong flavor of coconut. It's really refreshing and kind of floral, like I said, which is surprising. I've had a lot of different cendols. Well, here they call it dawet in Java, but this is probably the best one I've ever had. It's nice because it's kind of balanced with a little bit of savoriness. Oh, I love it. It's actually perfect for like breakfast. This market is crazy. It's such a cool traditional market. I think this just went up really close in the top 10 favorite markets of mine. They're using wood fire in this place, which is kind of insane. A little bit dangerous, I'd say, but very traditional. This market is a nice blend between fresh ingredients, fresh produce, meat, and also ready to eat items. And it's kind of hard to differentiate which stalls are selling what, but this is the next place, and I'm lined up to try something called Brambang Asem.
berapa sama ini?
So this is the shop right here. She's making it up. It's just two main ingredients. It's the steamed sweet potato leaves and then tempeh, and then it's all about this tamarind sauce that she puts on top. So I just ordered mine up. This is the tamarind sauce all over top of those sweet potato leaves. Some tempeh here. I'm not really familiar with this. It looks like maybe, I don't know, braised tempeh or something. And this is such a simple, kind of interesting combination of a dish. Let me try to get some of those sweet potato leaves and some tempeh and try that out. The sauce is awesome. Oh, it's spicy. It's sweet and spicy. The tempeh is really soft, almost like a tofu, but the sweet potato leaves have a little bit of a crunch left to them, and I can tell there's a lot of palm sugar in there because it's really sweet, actually, and a little bit tangy from the tamarind. Really interesting dish, a really interesting combination of just two simple ingredients, but it is good, it is good. Everything here seems to be a little sweet. Very traditional tasting. What a cool market. I am in love with the city already. You can just tell that people take a lot of pride in their food and Japanese culture. It's just crazy in here. I love the atmosphere. Oh, those were some good snacks to start the day. Got another rainy day here in Indonesia, but we've just popped over to the next restaurant, and this place is serving sate kambing, which is goat sate, and this place does it a little bit differently. They mince their meat, so it's minced, and it looks like it's on a little piece of bamboo, and then cooked on charcoal. Three beautiful goat satays, minced with some fat inside. We ordered like the mix, and look at it, it's about to kind of almost fall off the skewer. I think I'm just gonna pull it off with the spoon so I can get some of the onions on the bottom. A little tomato maybe. Let's try that. That's really good too. Really juicy. Because it's minced, I feel like the fat kind of renders, and instead of dripping into the charcoal grill, kind of absorbs into the rest of the satay. It's a little bit of a crisp layer on the outside too. Ketchup manis is the sauce, main sauce. He dunks it in a big bucket full of mixture. But on the sweet side, once again, that's a common theme here in Solo. Oh, that's really good. Let's go in for some more here. Look at how delicate it is. It's just gonna fall off the skewer, no problem at all. Oh, it's really, really smoky too, and juicy. Wow. And even though it's goat, you can't taste any gaminess at all. It tastes like beef. To be honest, I wouldn't be able to tell the difference at all. It's just so smoky. Kind of just had a funny realization that the dessert was probably the saltiest thing that I've tried so far in Solo. Everything is just doused in ketchup manis, the sweet soy sauce. And look, even the tables have ketchup manis on them. So I'm guessing that must be the lifeblood of Solo. This next spot is called Tangkleng Rica Rica. They're serving Tangkleng, which is a stir-fried ribs with a curry sauce. And it is all on charcoal, super smoky. There's sparks flying everywhere. It is not easy to film these guys cooking because I keep getting burnt by the little sparks and the ashes are all over the place. but it's supposed to be really good. This is a really famous stall here in Solo. There are four of these guys with woks, all with these huge flames, charcoal. The sparks are crazy. That is a serious fire hazard. They must get burned on the daily. I've just got burned like 20 times trying to film here. It is insane. Wow. It's like a firework show. It's a simple stir fry. They start with a little bit of oil and then some shallots and garlic, and then in goes the ribs and then that curry sauce, some tomato. I think they might have put a little bit of cabbage in there. But look at this. The atmosphere is absolutely crazy. And the guys are really friendly. I knew this place was popular, but I was just in the kitchen. I didn't know the dining room was this massive warehouse and just packed full of people. It is huge in here. These must be good. I'm excited. So this is the famous Tongklang Richa Richa. These are kambing, so these are goat ribs. Look at that. Beautiful, beautiful goat meat. I am so excited to try this out. That kitchen was absolutely intense. Look at that bone, clean off the bone. Lots of sauce on there. Oh man, that is phenomenal. Ooh, it's a little bit spicy actually. A nice sweet soy sauce flavor as well. Meat's not crazy tender. It's got a little bit of a leanness to it, but it is so smoky and quite spicy actually. I think I'm gonna be able to clean this one off, no problem. There's not a whole lot of meat on there, but what there is so good. Oh, that is addicting. Oh man, those are good. Mm. Let me give you another bowl for all the bones. Oh wow, that is awesome. There's different cuts in here. Like there's some different bones. They're not all ribs, but the ribs are really, really good. And the meat comes off them really simply. Yeah. Effortless. That's a perfect balance between sweet and spicy and smoky. Just how you want to have goat ribs. Super smoky, I love it. Those ribs were amazing. Look at this place. It's absolutely packed with locals. The whole restaurant is smoky from the charcoal grill out front. Wow, awesome. Oh, we got some live music too. Hey, let me see your face. You're covered in ashes. Next up on my Solo food tour, I'm going for salat solo, so Solo style salad, but you're gonna see this is not your typical salad, so let's go inside and order one up. Another packed out restaurant here in Solo, and like I said, this is not gonna be your typical salad, at least what we think of in the West. Here it is. First glance, I say it looks more like a soup, but this is salat solo. So it was invented during the Dutch colonial period to kind of cater towards the Dutch taste buds, but it's also got a Javanese flair. So the Dutch, they like meat. So there's beef in the salad, but the Javanese, they really like the veggies. So there's all kinds of veggies. We got carrots, green beans, cucumbers, and potatoes. And then there's a braised egg in here as well. And then this is cool. This is like a Indonesian mustard. Look at that. So I'll give it a kind of a little mix around. And I'm just gonna try some of this broth first. Definitely not what I think is a salad. I'd call this a soup, but let's try it. Oh, it's so sweet. It's so sweet and beefy. Just really sweet. I was not expecting that. I thought it was gonna be a little bit salty, but I can't taste any savoriness. It's like almost like dessert-like. Really sweet. That's interesting. Okay, let's go in for some of the goodies. Okay, I'll peel off
a piece of that beef. It almost looks like Taiwanese beef noodle beef, a really nice cut. And grab some veggies here. It's good, but it's too sweet in my opinion. It's really kind of catching me off guard. It tastes like it's going to be a beef stew, but then it kind of finishes with a really strong sweetness. Those veggies are just maybe lightly boiled, a little bit of crunch left to them, but the beef, very tender. Let's crack open this egg. That's not my favorite dish, but definitely very famous here in Solo. This restaurant's packed out with locals. It's something you've got to try here. Oh, there's a tomato under here too. Look at that, lots of veggies. The mustard with the sweetness, a little strange. It's all right.
Tastes like spaghetti sauce. I'm serious.
Like Jollibee spaghetti.
Tastes like spaghetti sauce, yes.
Jollibee sweet spaghetti sauce.
I mean, from the color, I expect it's gonna be like salty.
But it's really sweet, isn't it?
But can get a sense of like Westerner food. Yeah. I don't know what I mean. It's not like Asian food tastes like this. It's good though.
There is so much to try here in Solo. It's the perfect city to come if you want to go on a food tour. And all the restaurants are super popular with locals and Indonesian tourists and international tourists. That one wasn't my favorite, but still okay. We're gonna go for a dessert next. So this dessert is called sarabi. It is a fermented rice flour batter that is cooked in this little tiny, almost like a wok. And then after they lay down a little bit of the rice flour, they top it with some coconut milk and then cover it up with a little clay lid. And then it kind of fries, but in the middle, it stays like a little bit chewy. And you have two kinds, one with chocolate or?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Original and chocolate.
Original and chocolate. Okay, I think we're gonna try both. They've got so many of these. I don't know how many. Each one is
very delicious.
Very delicious?
Yes.
Each one is 3x6, so 18 times 6, whatever that is. Can't do math right now. Too hungry. Got a box of 10 sarabi and it is seriously heavy. I ordered half chocolate and half original, and this is how they come. Oh, they're wrapped up in little individual banana leaves. So let me grab one, and oh, there's a little piece of tape on it too. Let me open this up. This one I believe is the original. Yes. Oh, look at that. So just coconut and then that rice batter. Let's try it out. That is really nice. The inside is so ridiculously creamy. It's just like pure coconut milk cream on the inside with a little crunchy layer just at the top layer of where it was frying. But the middle, the bottom of that little bowl, that wok, is thick and really still kind of undercooked feeling. But then a nice crispy part right on the ends there. Oh. Those things are dense, heavier than I thought, bigger than I thought. It's got like a slightly fermented flavor too from that rice batter, but really coconutty and just a little bit sweet. Okay, here's the chocolate one. So they just put a little bit of chocolate sprinkles on it at the end. Oh, I can't even open it up. I was gonna open it up and show you, but you can see anyway on the outside that chocolate kind of seeping through. Same everything else, but just with a little bit of chocolate.
Yep, same thing, but with the chocolate, I honestly think I like the original kind better than the chocolate. I think the just natural coconut flavor is even better than that kind of processed chocolate addition. Still good, but it's all about the original. It's so creamy on the inside. You can see they leave it a little bit undercooked, almost. I wouldn't call it a pancake, but it's somewhere in the same family.
Of Solo tonight for some more street food, and this place is specializing in bistek, which is different beef stir fry. So you can get beef meat stir fry, organs, and also apparently their ox tongue stir fry is supposed to be pretty good. And this place is just as hardcore as all the street food stalls here in Solo. Their setup is quite simple, right on the side of the street, a couple burners with big propane flames, and they're stir frying like crazy, just chucking the ingredients into those woks, and it reminds me of a Cantonese Dai Pai Dong in Hong Kong. The stir fry action is just intense. So apparently it's gonna be a 45 minute wait because they're doing each dish one by one, which is common here in Java. They really do everything to order, fresh, and that's the way it should be. It's a little bit of a wait, but I think the flavor is gonna be great. So let's go check it out and find a seat and have some bistek. They're running this stall is there's three guys that's job is just solely on the wok, and then one guy's chopping on the ingredients and then throwing everything in. I guess I don't know who to call really the chef. It's a real teamwork here. One guy's calculating how much of each ingredient to put in while the other guy's calculating how long to cook it. So it's quite the operation.
1 hour and 5 minutes later, you gotta be dedicated here in Solo to eat out, because it's gonna be an event. It takes all night, it feels like, to get your food, but here's the bistek. So stir fried, it's really like a soupy stir fry. There's some tomatoes in there, some chilies, lots of ketchup anise, and then the beef, of course. And then over here, we've got the fried ox tongue. Not the most beautiful presented dish, but let's try it out and find out if it's good. There's some fried shells on top. I gotta start with this bistek though. And looks like there's also potatoes and carrots in there. Almost looks like a stew. And I'm guessing it might be a little sweet because everything else that I've tried here in Solo today has been quite sweet. So let's try this one out with a little bit of rice. It is like a beef stew. It is spicy and a little bit sweet. Nothing like the salad though. It's a lot spicier too. There's definitely quite a bit of chilies in there, and the potatoes are nice and soft. It reminds me of just like a Canadian beef stew like my grandmother would make, but a little bit sweeter from that sweet soy sauce. Not like super special, but it is satisfying. There's a lot going on in here. Grab a piece of the ox tongue here. This has just been fried. It feels a little crispy on the outside, and it feels really tough. Oh my God. I don't even think I'm gonna be able to pull that apart with a spoon. Oh, maybe I can. All right, let's try that. That's surprising. The texture was really kind of unique. It's crunchy and crispy on the outside, and I thought it was gonna be tough the whole way through, but on the inside, it's smooth and tender with a little bit of a crunch on the outside. The flavor, nothing really, just beefy.
All right. I don't know if it's worth an hour, 10 minutes wait or whatever, but it's pretty good.
I feel like the flavors are quite old school Javanese. It's like a authentic Javanese stir fry restaurant. Everything's a little bit greasy, a little bit sweet, a little bit spicy, but it is satisfying.
Good food?
Yes.
Worth an hour and a half of sweating my ass off and people smoking cigarettes? Nope. But luckily these guys were here to entertain us with some music.
For breakfast today in Jogja, I am deep inside the heart of this little market here and I've come to have something called jenang. This woman is selling it. She's got all the ingredients right in front of her. This one is rice balls with palm sugar. This is tapioca, rice powder, and then in the back some more palm sugar. And then at the end, she pours a little bit of coconut milk on top and this is the final result. It's this super goopy, sloppy mixture which is served hot. You can see the rice balls in there, some tapioca, everything is mixed with that palm sugar and coconut. Look at the texture of that. That is really, really unique. Let's try it out.
That is awesome. Oh, way better than I was expecting.
Just a hint of sweetness. It's not as sweet as I thought it was gonna be, but it's really strong coconut flavor. Served warm. It's kind of like a porridge. In other parts of Indonesia, they call it bubur. It's the same sort of dish, but a little bit different here at this stall. Very traditional, served right in the banana leaf on a bamboo little bowl here. Wow, that is really good. Mm. The texture is like hot mochi. It's kind of gooey and melty. Let's try one of these balls, rice balls that have been kind of marinated in the palm sugar. The palm sugar tastes so good. It's not super sweet, but it's got a really nice flavor. Mm. Very chewy, bouncy. Mm. That is delicious. What a way to start the day. Yum. Mm.
All right, terima kasih.
Thank you, bye.
That was delicious. I could eat that for breakfast every day. So comforting. It's warm and a little bit sweet. A perfect way to start the day. That was awesome. Next stop, we're going for soto ayam, which is chicken soup. This place is called Warung Soto Kadipiro, and it is a super popular spot. I think there's gonna be a little bit of a wait, and this is supposed to be some of the best chicken soup in all of Jogja, so let's go try it out. This place is absolutely packed. You can just tell that Jogja is a food city. A lot of people from other parts of the country, but a lot of locals here as well. And they're serving only the soto ayam. You can see just bowls upon bowls of it. And they're boiling the broth on charcoal. It's just got a couple little veggies like cabbage and some green onions I saw in there, and then some chicken. And then you order it with the rice in the soup. So let's try it out. I'm super excited. It must be good. It is absolutely madness in here, and I love the decor. They've got all these old traditional art pieces on the wall. You can feel the history in this spot. And I've got my bowl of soto ayam. There is a like fried potato patty in it as well. Lots of chicken, the rice of course. I thought there was green onions, but now I think it was just some cilantro. And you gotta add some of this sambal that's on the table, which looks like there's just a ton of different things in it, special mixture. So I'll go for a spoonful of that, give it a little mix. Oh man, I can smell it. It smells incredible. Let's try.
Mm. Oh, I thought that was cilantro, but it's actually celery. It's got a nice spiciness now from that sambal and really strong chicken flavor. It's a thin, light broth. It's not like thick, it's not murky. It's kind of like a clear broth.
It's pretty simple and just kind of home cooked, homey tasting, really comfort food. Wow, that is good. And there's only little bits of shredded chicken in there. There's not a whole lot of chicken. It's mostly just the rice. You can order with or without rice. Definitely heartier to have the rice. Their sambal tastes amazing. Yeah, that's comfort food at its finest.
Pretty simple ingredients, but all of the flavor is coming from the broth. Let me try this potato patty, which looks like it's completely soggy and soaked up all of that broth.
Whoa, it just melts, falls apart in your mouth. Actually, that is really good in it. Yum. Oh, I wish there was more than just one potato patty in there. That's a damn good bowl.
This sambal is just pretty much heat. There's not any sourness to it. It's just got a lot of spice to it, but it's really delicious. And guys, we need more soups with rice.
Soup and rice together is really good, always. Yeah, that sambal is really phenomenal. The portion sizes here in Indonesia are usually quite small, and that's good because you're gonna wanna taste a lot of different stuff when you're on your trip here. And everything is so cheap, 18,000 for one bowl. This place is absolutely legendary, an institution here in Yogyakarta. I am really excited for this next stop. It's called 25 Bapia. So they're specializing in bapia, which is a mung bean cake that is famous here in Jogja. It's only sold here in Jogja, and it is so extremely popular that they are employing hundreds of different employees and serving thousands of these bapia, selling out every single day. We're gonna get a special opportunity to go into the factory and see how they're making their famous bapia. So let's go inside and see how it's done, and then I'm gonna try one out once we're finished. It's a traditional factory. There's gonna be, I don't know, 200 people working in here, and they're all making the bapia. So it is, like I said, a mung bean filled cake. They start with a batter that they make into long kind of snake-like shapes, and then cut them into little pieces. And then those pieces are flattened out by hand, stuffed full of the green bean, the mung bean, and they've just got mounds of this mung bean in front of them, and then they make them up by hand, and that's it. It's pretty simple, but they are making tons of these. I can't believe how much action is going on in here. It is just crazy. I love the atmosphere, and I can't believe how much mung bean is on the table. There's gonna be tons of it in here, and everybody's just got a big mound of it in front of them, and they're all making them up one by one. So cool, whoa. Okay, once they are finished making them by hand, then it's time to bake them. And this is gonna be the craziest oven room I have ever seen. They have 8 of these massive charcoal ovens that have these kind of sliding trays that come out, and they fill them full of the bapia and then put them inside, and they're flipping them by hand, and they come out golden crispy charcoal. The scale of this operation is just astounding. They must be making tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of these every single day, and everything is done by hand. There's no automation, there's no timers. They're just looking at the bapia and saying, are they finished?
and judging everything by eye and using charcoal. So it's really the most authentic way to do it. And I guess that's why they taste so good. I'm getting really excited to try these out. Working in here must be like hell though, because it is so hot. Oh my gosh. Once they're finished baking, cool them off for a few minutes, and then they're straight into the box to the consumer, hot and fresh out of the oven. Just look at the amount of boxes they're gonna fill here today. Wow, look at this. It's taller than me. This place is absolutely insane. So they're grinding and cooking the mung beans in here. Look at all of these blenders. And they're using wood fire to cook the mung beans. So cool, so traditional. This place is absolutely insane. You know, I have a weird job where I get to go inside of a lot of factories to film, but I have to say, that is my new favorite factory. I've never seen one that's doing it so traditionally with the charcoal and everything. Everything by hand, everything by sight and feel. Really cool, so it's time to try them out. The time has come to try the famous 25 baht pia, and look at these little guys. They are absolutely beautiful. They remind me of Chinese Shenzhen bao, like fried dumplings, almost filled with that mung bean. And apparently this is the last box that they have today, and people will fight over these things, I've been told. They sell it every single day. They've got hundreds of workers, and I am so excited to try. Hot and fresh still. Let's try it out. Yum. That is really good. It's kind of got a nutty flavor on the inside. Really creamy mung bean. And then a bit of a crunch on the outside. It's kind of starchy and a little hint of sweetness, but not too much. It's a really kind of vegetable-y flavor, I guess you could say. Oh yeah, yeah, those are good. Those are addicting. They're so creamy on the inside with that little kind of crunchy outside. Perfect combination of texture, subtle sweetness. Okay, I get the hype. Those are absolutely delicious. I just destroyed four of them in like less than 30 seconds. And I was just being told by the owner here that they have a lot of Japanese customers. Apparently the Japanese love these, and I can see why. It does kind of remind me of a Japanese like taiyaki or some kind of mung bean sweet. They use a lot of mung bean in Japan, so really good. Gotta try it out. It's one of the most famous dessert shops, probably the most famous dessert shop in all of Yogyakarta. After that quick little sweets break at the bakpia factory, I've now come to a really local joint for some chicken. Let's go into the kitchen and see what they're cooking. I love Yogyakarta's kitchens. They are always a feast for all the senses, and they're always doing things traditionally. Look at this chicken here. This is braised chicken. So this place is braising their chicken, and then they're gonna flash fry it after. And here is the braise, cooking on a wood fire, absolutely bubbling hot. Full chicken's in there. There's gonna be tons of ginger, galangal, turmeric, all kinds of different things. Wow, it's just so authentic, so real. I love it. This looks like awesome chicken. So after it's been braised, they're gonna fry it, and I am looking forward to trying this out. Wow, so cool. That braising mixture just looks like it's gonna be so full of flavor, and one of the pots is just full of just chicken legs. I didn't know you could just order the chicken legs, I guess so. But they've got full chickens braising in there, and I guess we're gonna go see how they fry them up next. We have a spread of different dishes, with the highlight being the braised fried chicken, but we've also got some fresh veggies, cucumbers, lemon basil, some stir-fried papaya leaves, looks like with some garlic and chilies in there. Back here, some fried eggplant. There is some fried tempeh as well. and then two types of sambal on the table. But really, like I said, the highlight is this guy right here. The braised and fried chicken. Look at how beautiful that is. And we're going local style with the fingers. So I'm just gonna go right in there and try a piece as is by itself. No sambal, just with the braise. That came right off the bone, no problem. Let's try. Wow. Even though it's fried chicken, it's not crunchy fried chicken because they just quickly flash fry it and it's been braising for God knows how long. But the flavor of that braise is just incredible. You can taste the ginger in there. It's not really strong, but it's really delicious. I think it could go good with some sambal. Let me go in a little bit of sambal and rice. I'll grab another piece of chicken. And then this is a spicy looking sambal. There's two sambals. I'll go for this one. I've been told this is a little bit spicier. Oh, that might have been a little overkill. Let's try that with some rice. That is good chicken. Wow, it's so moist and juicy still. That sambal adds a lot of flavor. There's a lot of garlic in there. A little bit spicy. It's not actually as spicy as I was expecting, but that chicken, so juicy, succulent chicken. Man, that is really, really good. A lot of natural flavor from that braise. This might be the best chicken I've had, definitely, in a long time. Put that on the rice. Let me grab one of these eggplants and a little bit of lemon basil as well. And the sambal is awesome too. Lots of garlic in there. I love the garlic flavor. Mix that up. Go in with fingers. Let's try.
That is so good. The lemon basil really freshens it up. I love the creamy eggplant with it too. Also not crispy even though it's been fried. That sambal is so full of flavor. But that chicken, so succulent, delicious. Look at this. It just comes right off the bone. Oh man, that braise, whatever secret ingredients they got in there, is so, so good. I'm gonna grab some of these papaya leaves here. Going in with the fingers. Always a little bit confusing at first, but once you get the hang of it, a lot of people say it actually makes the food taste better. I don't know about that, but. Those are a little bit sweet, actually. Yum. Fried chicken is insane. Ooh, I actually feel like I've had that. It is so hot. We spent all that time in the bakpia oven room. Then we came here, and then we're in their oven room. And now this food is super spicy. Look at that. Beautiful bite, though. With the lemon basil and the sambal. This sambal is so good. Lots of garlic in there. Oh man. This is dangerous. Oh. Oh my god. That's so good with the lemon basil and the garlic. Oh man. I'm sweating bullets. Can you see that? Oh, I can't stop eating. It's so good. Oh, I actually think I ate it all already. Oh my god, that was the best meal of the day for sure. But I feel like I'm like high right now on psychedelic chicken. I'm just gonna start hallucinating here shortly. Whew, that was spicy as hell. Let me tell you guys a secret. Why I know so much about Indonesian food. It's actually Ari. Film Ari.
Hello, sawadikap, sugeng rawo in Jogja.
He's the real guru of Indonesian food that makes me sound smart every time. We're gonna go get some what? Fruity ice?
Es buah.
Ice buah. We need to cool off because I'm gonna pass
out. We're like, see? And look, we are soaking wet from the weather and also from the spiciness of the sambal. And from the oven of the bakpia factory and all the kitchen here in Bandung in Jogja.
I can't even feel my tongue my hands. My hands burning from the chili, eating with your fingers. So maybe they say it might taste better, but honestly, it's like it's a hazard because my hand is burning from sambal right now. All right, ice time. A really cool street food stall serving shaved ice. She shaves it by hand with a block of ice, just shaving, and then it's all on a bed of fruit, and then she puts some palm sugar syrup and then a red syrup and some chocolate on top. So this is the final product here. Like I said, there's fruit on the bottom here. I'm not really sure what kind of fruits were down there, but all kinds of different things. Oh, I see some jellies. Oh yeah, this is sago seeds, I believe it is. Let's try it out. Woo, lots of stuff. Mm. Oh, that's really good. The chocolate's actually really good with it. It's not super sweet, nice and refreshing, of course. You get those kind of jellies on the bottom once you're kind of chewy. Oh, that's refreshing. Perfect after that spicy chicken. Mm. Oh, the chocolate is nice. And I'm getting deeper into there. I thought it was fresh fruits, but it seems like jellied fruits, all kinds of different things. Maybe that's a piece of mango. I'm not really sure what's down there, but let's try it. Mm-hmm. Yum. Everything here in Jogja, it's so traditional. No shaved ice machines. Everything by hand. I love it. It makes it taste better. Ari just corrected me. This is not a sago seed. They call it atap seeds. And look at this. There's avocado in it. That is awesome. Let's try the avocado. Mm-hmm. Yum. So creamy. That's awesomely refreshing. Oh, that's just what I needed.
Mmm. Pulls me down from that spicy. From the sambal.
Taking a quick stroll through the Bogor market, fresh market. You can see lots of meat, lots of veggies. All of the produce for the city is, most of it at least, is coming from the central market. Really bustling place, full of different ingredients. It's pretty hardcore, old school market. Looks like they've never ever washed or cleaned this place, ever. Okay, I'm heading to the first restaurant. My first stop is this really, really authentic street food stall. It's just a little tent on the side of the road. It's called Toge Goreng Ibu Efon. So they're serving Toge Goreng. He starts by cutting up ketupat, that compressed rice cake, and then some tofu, and then he blanches some bean sprouts in this copper pot that he's got heated on wood fire. And then the bean sprouts go on top of that tofu and ketupat, and then he tops it with a ton of fermented bean, soybean paste, and then a little bit of ketchup manis, and then sambal, and that's it. So I've got it right here. No meat in here. The sambal, he just kept it right in the spoon. So I'm gonna give it a little bit of a mix. And you can see a piece of tofu there, all those bean sprouts, the compressed rice cake, the ketupat. So there's noodles in there as well as the bean sprouts. He blanched them both together. Mmm. Guys, bursting with flavor. That soybean paste is really dominating the flavor. It's a little bit spicy from the sambal too, and it's got a sweetness to it. It's a nice contrast between the crisp bean sprouts and then the really soft rice cake and tofu in there, but all the flavor is from that soybean paste, which is
actually quite sweet.
This spot is really the definition of street food stall, cooking with wood fire. This is nothing when his stall is gone, it's just a road, and then with just this little tarp over top, and then serving some really delicious, hearty, cheap eats. If you order for takeaway, he just wraps it up in a couple banana leaves. Really good for the environment, but then he puts it in a plastic bag, so kind of defeats the purpose. Here at the stall, they're doing everything the traditional way, from the takeaway in the banana leaf to using a pipe to maintain that flame underneath to keep the temperature the right temperature. Really good food and such a cool stall. Just moving right along to the next spot here in Bogor. So as I was walking down the street, I spotted this guy with a little push cart selling something called ice beer kochok. So it's not beer, but he calls it beer, and it's kochok means to shake. So what it really is like a ginger ale. So he uses a mixture of ginger, cinnamon, cloves, palm sugar, and then with the ice, he just shakes it, and then pours it in a bag. Sticking with the ruining the environment theme, he puts it in a bag. With a straw. So I'm gonna try it out. Really authentic, just a little push cart, and he's right outside of the Indomart, the convenience store here. Let me try out the ice beer kochok. Oh my gosh, so sweet. Wow. Yeah, so most drinks here in Indonesia are gonna be really sweet. You're gonna wanna ask for less sugar, but the flavor of the ginger in there, really refreshing. You can taste the cinnamon and cloves, a little bit of spiciness. And it's definitely nice and cold, but a little bit too sweet for me. So the owner here, his father started this business in 1965, selling this exact same drink. He used to have it on one of the yokes, the things that you carry on your shoulder, but now he's got it on this push cart. And I wouldn't totally recommend, if you are not seasoned street food eater or you haven't traveled in Asia much, to have too many drinks on the street with ice like that. But he's been around since 1965, so I think I'm gonna be okay. I hope I'm gonna be okay. The nice thing about Bogor is that this one street, the Chinatown, has all the famous stops. So really close to the last stop, I've just come to Soto Mi Bogor Pakumis. So they're serving Soto Mi, which is like a noodle soup. And you go in and try it out. Really like all the colorful decor on the front. The soto mi here in Bogor consists of two types of mi, so two types of noodles, bakmi, the egg noodle, and then bihun, the thin rice noodle, and a little bit of cabbage that he blanches and then puts into the bowl. Next up, he chops up some really crunchy spring rolls. It's just a flour spring roll, and then he puts in some sliced tomato, and then the meat. I ordered just beef. You can also order it with skin. Then he puts a little bit of parsley with green onions, and then on top of that, the ketchup manis, the sweet soy sauce, and then in comes the rich red broth where all that flavor is going to come from, and then it's topped with just some fried shallots. So that is the famous soto mi here in Bogor. Let's go try it out. This is the final result. Beautiful bowl of soto mi. You can see all the different ingredients in there. There's that little spring roll, there's some meat, the two types of noodles, and you can and should dress it with some sambal, but I'm just going to try some of the broth with a little bit of the meat first for my first bite before I dress it up. Oh, that is lovely.
it's a really clear, clean, healthy tasting broth. You can taste those fried shallots in there. You get a really strong flavor of the fried shallots. I'm gonna go in for some sambal here. So nice, beautiful looking sambal. Go for one big scoop in the middle. Give it a mix. And there's a lot going on in this bowl. Really sloppy, ugly, delicious bowl of noodles. And also go for some lime here. Oh, the two types of noodles is a really good addition. It's nice to have the contrast and textures there with a little bit of spiciness now from the sambal, but it's really a healthy tasting broth. Not oily, not greasy at all. Really delicious. I love it. Let me try one of these kind of soggy now spring rolls. Still got a crunch to it. There's all kinds of things in here. Tomato. Oh, that is a beautiful bowl of noodles. I love it.
Killer bowl of noodles. That is exactly how I want my noodles. And you could dress it with the spicy sambal and the lime. It's just so satisfying. And keep going on this food tour here in Bogor. Oh, it's also so cheap. Only 15,000 per bowl. So super, super cheap. Let's go. I think Bogor is the perfect place for a walking food tour if you want to have a food tour one day when you're on your trip to Jakarta, because it's easy to get to. You just take the train to the last stop is Bogor, and then you can just walk down this street. It's really simple and there's tons of good spots. All the information for the places I visited today will be down in the description box. The amount of street food, like legit street food on carts, stalls that are movable here in Indonesia might be the most in the world that I've seen. Well, India is another big one, but wow, I'm really just impressed at how much street food. It's just never ending while you walk along the sidewalk. Just to give you an idea of how much street food is available on the sidewalks here in Bogor, this is a cow's mouth salad that you can get. And then right over here, there's a grilled corn salad. And then right behind me, you've got dessert. This is martabak. Next stop on my Bogor food tour is for laksa, the Singaporean favorite, but this is not Singaporean laksa, this is Indonesian laksa. So it's similar, it's a curry noodle, and she puts an egg on top. She uses just a little string to cut the egg, which is quite cool. And this is a really authentic stall once again. Chickens out on the street and just a few stools on the other side of the road. Sitting down now with my laksa, and like I mentioned, a very popular dish in Singapore, but feels like I'm in another world completely than Singapore, sitting on the streets of Bogor here with chickens running around my feet. But this bowl of laksa certainly looks delicious. It's a coconut milk with turmeric base broth. There's bihun, the noodles in there. There's ketupat, the compressed rice cake. Tofu, there's lemon basil in there. The egg, and then a little bit of toasted grated coconut on top. And it just looks like such a milky, thick broth. Oh, and also another important ingredient is that fermented soy. You can see that little hint of red in there. That's the fermented soy, so that's gonna give a lot of flavor as well. With that lemon basil in there, such a fresh citrusy flavor, really creamy coconut broth, strong coconut flavor too, because you have both the coconut milk broth and the toasted grated coconut on top there. It's a really thick, rich broth.
Definitely leaning on the sweet side though. This tofu is just bright yellow from the turmeric. I love the lemon basil in there. That's really good. Besides the lemon basil in there and the coconut, the other dominant flavor is the oncham, which is the fermented soy. This beats any Singapore laksa that I've had, to be totally honest with you. Sorry Singaporeans, but you gotta come try this place too.
Next up, I'm at this little stall called Lumpia Basa. It's just a tiny little green stall on the side of the road. She's using charcoal to make the filling for lumpia, which is a spring roll. So it's a fresh spring roll, it's not fried. And she's using a little weave fan to keep that charcoal heat going. Really tight quarters here. The filling for the lumpia mainly consists of some fried garlic, eggs, pickled jicama, and some bean sprouts, and then it's wrapped up in a flour dough wrapper. So it's not like a Vietnamese spring roll in a rice paper or anything. It's actually just in this kind of bouncy dough, similar to a Taiwanese spring roll, but smaller, and then served in this little banana leaf. Let me try it out. Ooh. I don't love it, that's for sure. It tastes like there's definitely some dried fish or dried shrimp in there. Maybe it's shrimp paste. It's really overpowered with that fish flavor. Crunchy pickled jicama, but really traditional spring roll. But yeah, I don't love it, to be totally honest with you. That's the only thing today that I tried that wasn't amazing.
So for our first stop of today's tour, we're gonna be eating a ton of food today. So this is just the very first stop of the day. They're serving something called bubur ayam. It's sort of like a congee, so like a rice soup. And they've topped it with the famous Indonesian keropok, so the tapioca crackers. He kind of just takes a whole handful of them, crunches them up, and this is bubur ayam, so it's chicken bubur. So he shreds a little bit of chicken on there. Some spices in there, very simple breakfast. We're gonna sit down and have ours. This is a really cool area with tons of street food. It's just right in front of a mosque as well. Tons of locals here. Let's go eat. So as usual on any Indonesia trip, I'm joined by my Indonesian food guru, Mr. Ari.
Welcome back, Luke.
Yeah, I'm excited to be here. We're here in Jakarta, capital city, right?
Mm-hmm. Your fourth time?
I think maybe fourth. I lost track. We got our bubur ayam.
The quintessential Indonesian breakfast.
Breakfast, okay.
Many versions all over countries, right. But this one is one of the main ones.
And they're like serving tons and tons of people all at once.
And this is a must, like for most Indonesian, is sambal and maybe a little touch of
you pour it right on top?
Yes.
Okay, you show me how much. I want to see it. So I know how, okay, you're going generous. This looks totally different than the bubur ayam that we had in Bali.
Oh yeah.
Completely different, right?
That one with the curry and a lot of veggie salad, right?
Yeah. This one's got all those like crunchy carapace.
Just a touch of ketchup manis.
Look at that. And a little ketchup manis, a little sweet. Such an interesting
some also
dish.
With the curry sauce, but this one is from Haji Jewo, is without.
Oh yeah, no curry sauce.
Mm. We got like some discussion here.
Yeah.
You get two schools of people. The one that stirred their bubur and the one that didn't stir.
I guess I just joined a group without even knowing. Because I stirred mine up. It's such a colorful dish with the different the keropok, all the different colors and the crackers.
This place opened from 5 in the morning.
From 5 in the morning.
Because the morning prayer finished around 5.
Okay.
So they just go breakfast in bubur Haji Jewo.
Right.
Until maybe 9:30, 10 finish.
Delicious. You know, this sort of congee dish, find it all across Asia. We were just actually having it in Vietnam, but this is like totally different with the crackers on top, and the flavor is different too. After you put that sambal, it gives it a little spice, and it's a super hearty filling dish, even though we are starting with this before we eat tons more food today. It's really good.
Personally,
I don't eat congee that often, but this one, it's good. It's like say welcome to Indonesia. I'm excited to eat more Indonesian food.
Okay, now time for Indonesian coffee, and then after that we will try West Sumatran breakfast.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Welcome to Java.
So we're at a Sumatran restaurant called Bopet Mini. This is an absolute legendary spot. I actually came here about 5 years ago. Today we're here, it is absolutely packed with locals. Like, I mean, it is so packed in here. They have nasi padang, so all the different kind of things you can eat with rice, which is especially popular in the morning for breakfast. We're not going to try the nasi padang, we're gonna try a couple of their other dishes. They've also got this little sweet station here. So we ordered up something a little sweet, some different things. We, of course, have to taste the rendang though. That's just the quintessential Minangkabau style food. So let's try to find a table and sit down and eat.
Wow, this is ketupat sayur.
Okay.
The rice cake with curry and then salaloa.
And
this is like the fritters, rendang, beef rendang. And this one is sweet bubur called bubur kampiun, the specialty of Minang people in Minangkabau. All the good sweet.
Where are we gonna sit?
Sit upstairs.
Okay, I'll follow you.
Oh wow.
It's a bit of a challenge to get a seat here, but you kind of just have to stand and...
with your eagle look,
yeah, watching
on the table.
Waiting until somebody's generous enough to give up their seat.
This one is a katupe sayua.
So katupe. Yeah.
Katupat is a... we call it katupe in Minang.
It's these like rice, cakes,
rice cake.
Yeah.
And they put curries. In this case, they put two kinds of curries.
Okay.
The fern tips.
Fern curry, tips.
And then the young jackfruit.
Young jackfruit, okay. Yeah. And then there's some little
it's fried... this, we call it salaloa.
Okay.
So like the fritters.
Fritters, yeah.
From the Pariaman area in West Sumatra.
And there's the jackfruit.
The
look at
that. Jackfruit. There's no Indonesian root without crackers.
Without the crackers, yeah.
In Sumatran, they put this pink crispy crackers, yeah.
And I know this one here. The world's best food, right?
The world's best food.
Yes, rendang.
And what make it better at this place? Because they put some red beans in
Some red beans, okay.
Yeah.
That's
so it's rendang. Daging, beef, but with the kacang merah.
Okay. For the uninformed, it's a coconut-based beef.
Caramelized.
Yeah, caramelized.
Seven hours.
Cooked forever, yeah. This is bubur as well.
Bubur kampiun. Okay. Kampiun actually came from the word champion.
Champion,
because
champion
that time,
bubur.
There is a like a contest, and this is the type of bubur that win the contest.
Oh yeah?
So they name it champion.
Champion bubur. So it's like a coconut milk?
There's so many, many
different things. Yeah, what's this right in the middle though?
This one is my favorite one is like the cinnamon flan.
Cinnamon flan.
Yes, we call it sarikayu.
Wow.
Sarikayu.
So much going on here.
And we get like mung bean and then potato balls, bananas, all the sweet coconut milk, all types of jelly, six, seven kinds.
Oh, it's really
so
crispy.
So this is crispy, right?
Yeah.
So the crispiness mixed with the broad is very nice.
Mm-hmm. I gotta try it with a piece of this jackfruit too, though.
Yeah. The broth is already mixed between the pork tips and the young jackfruit.
It's not spicy, but it's got a little bit of a kick to it.
Yeah, usually they put a little bit of sambal lado on the side to put more spicy, but this is okay for
it's
breakfast.
It's like a thin curry, it's like a really soupy curry, not like an Indian curry where it's like super creamy and rich, but that jackfruit is so soft.
Yeah.
And then this is the ketupat, the rice cake, you gotta have it with that. So much flavor in this food.
And this kind of food, ketupat sayur, it's good for breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
This is kind of all day food.
Right.
But usually it's served also for...
Oh. It's so good. The rice cake soaks up all that flavor. And what were you telling me about Minangkabau? What does that actually mean? What does that translate to? Minang is
to win.
Winner. The winner, yeah.
Kabau is?
The caribou, right? Or the...
Yeah, Kerbau.
Kerbau.
Or buffalo.
Buffalo, right. So they had a competition, I guess, way back in the day.
With the Javanese.
With the Japanese and the Sumatran, West Sumatrans. And the West Sumatrans... Kabau won. So they call Minangkabau the winning,
buffalo.
This place, Bopet Mini, is just legendary. So busy, you can see it's packed with locals. And then the number one Minangkabau food, at least for foreigners like me,
is got to be the rendang. And their rendang, as Ari was saying, is a little special because they've got the red beans in it, which is super interesting. Oh. Oh my god. Really kind of coconutty, a little bit sweet, definitely leaning on the sweet side. And the beef is like almost like a jerky type beef. Like it's a little chewy. It's not super tender, but the flavor is just like just a bomb of flavor in your mouth. It's amazing.
And you know what? The sweet taste is not from the sugar. Minang never cook the savory dish with sugar.
With the palm sugar?
Never. With
no?
Any sugar.
No sugar?
Nah. With this
what?
One with the caramelized coconut milk.
Oh,
like
wow.
6-7 hours, they become sweet and sweeter. But actually in West Sumatra, we get 20-25 different kinds of rendang.
Okay.
Maybe half of them are vegetarian.
I have to say to any vegetarians watching today, if you've never had jackfruit, especially jackfruit in Indonesia, when it's cooked right, it is nearly identical to like a pulled meat or like a beef brisket or something. The texture is just incredible. You must have jackfruit rendang as well, right?
Yes, yeah. Jackfruit rendang.
That would be good.
We call it rendang cubada.
Mm. All right, let's try this dessert.
Bubur champion.
Bubur champion.
Bubur champion.
Yeah. Swimming in all kinds of different things.
Yeah.
Coconut. So
try to take a little bit of everything.
Try to get some of everything.
Of course you cannot.
So colorful. You can't.
At least you try. At least you try. Try this one, cinnamon.
I did. Yeah.
This is my favorite part of the dish.
You get all those different textures, like the beans are sort of creamy, but then you get the chewy.
They're not too sweet because there's many savory components, like the sticky rice.
Right.
It's not sweet at all, just a little bit savory. It's very
I
nice
feel like people in America, Canada, they see this doesn't look like a dessert that they've never seen before, but once you taste it, I swear you're gonna love it.
Deconstructed dessert.
So I went with nasi padang because it's been a long time since I didn't have curry, so I really craving for it. So I order a bamboo shoot, and this is a cassava leaf, and this one is
gulai ayam,
chicken curry,
and some sambal.
Yeah, and some spicy sambal.
We call it balado. Balado.
Mmm, this is what I'm waiting for. Oh my god, I'm happy.
This place just has one of the most crazy displays of food I've ever seen. Well, most nasi padang, Minang Kabau style restaurants have this kind of crazy buffet, or sometimes they bring it all to your table actually. And this used to just be a tiny stall in the market, and now look at it, it's just absolutely packed with locals. That was really delicious. We're gonna keep going, 24 hours eating street food here in Jakarta. Let's go.
I feel like this is like a food competition because it's not easy to get a table, and you have to get in line to order the food, and then because there's a lot of people waiting in line, once you get the food, you not get the table. You have to wait to get the table, staring at people, eating, pressuring them. But once we get the table, we get the same pressure from other people too, so I think that's what it is.
Where are we now, Ari?
We are in Rujak Sultan, Rujak Bang Sultan, in the middle of Jakarta, just nearby the welcome statue of Jakarta. They serve the fruit salad, so they make from all this fruit, they make into a salad.
Right.
Lobi-lobi, pineapple, and they use like gandaria, young mango.
What's this one?
Jambu, and this one is torch ginger. This one to make the sauce. So they crush the pots right here, it's very aromatic. They mix it with peanut, with palm sugar, chili, and some fish paste, terasi, to make the sauce. And they mix it with all the sliced up fruits.
So as Ari was saying, they're serving rujak here, which is like a fruit salad, but this one's really unique. I've never seen one quite like this. They have so many tropical fruits that I've not seen before. Like, I mean, I'm not totally sure what all of these different things are. Ari knows the local names for them, but you can see just so many different kinds. This one back here is like a little tiny ones, super juicy. And so he's got one big stone pot of all of the sauce that he's made with some of the fruit, but there's also going to be some sugar, some different things in it. And it's using this special ginger fruit that Ari was just talking about, which gives it a really unique flavor. And then he takes a huge bucket of the cut up fruit and then mixes it with the sauce and just gets it completely coated. So yeah, it's like a fruit salad, but like next level fruit salad. I'm excited to try it. It smells super fragrant. So many different fruits that I've never tried before. I do recognize a couple of them. I can see the wax apple, I can see pineapple, I can see papaya. I'm just gonna go in and get a spoonful. Oh, there's even cucumber in there. Just gonna get a kind of spoonful of everything and make sure I get lots of that sauce. I see star fruit in there. There's like 15 different fruits all in this. Whoa.
Yum. Oh, it's got a spice to it.
It's a super unique flavor from that really interesting torch ginger. It's got sort of a gingery spice to it. I don't know how to explain it. I've never tasted anything quite like it. Let me try one more bite. It's definitely on the sweet side. They use palm sugar in this. And not salty, but it's got a little bit of salt in it, or a little bit of savoriness. Just look at how much fruit is in there. There's so much. Star fruit, papaya, some crazy things that I don't even know the names of in English. It's just such a flavor bomb. So much better than fruit salad in Canada, which is basically just fruit cut up, put together with nothing else in it. That one has a seed. Oh, that one's sour. Oh, that one's super sour. Yum. Sorry, he's giving me some cassava cracker.
There's no Indonesian word without crackers.
With the cracker. You just dip it in, grab it. Okay. A little spoonful. Oh. Gotta watch out for the seeds. You'll quickly start to realize here in Indonesia that everything goes with a cracker. Pretty much everything here can be and should be eaten with something crunchy like this cracker here. I love the sauce. It's like super full of flavor. I don't even know how to explain it. It's super complex. There's so much going on in there. And that torch ginger gives it such a unique essence. I've never tasted anything like it. Wow.
All right, I'm gonna try the cracker with the juice.
I'm dim.
Oh, wow. It's like perfect sour. It's so good. Like, but I have to admit that normally I'm not a fruit lover, but if you are a fruit lover, this is your fruit heaven.
Right there. Only $1.
Only $1.
15 kind of fruits. Green apples, sweet potato, chermay, chambu.
Sweet potato is a fruit?
This one is sweet potato.
I thought that was papaya.
This one is papaya. This one is sweet potato.
Geez, they have everything in there.
Yeah.
Which one's your favorite?
Kedondong, the sour carambola. And also the chermay, the green one. This one, chermay.
You mean the two fruits that I've never heard of in my life?
Yeah.
When you're a tourist like me, that's how you know you're in Southeast Asia, when they have 15 different fruits and the only one you recognize is pineapple. So we've made it to our next stop. We're having something called ayam penyet. So it's a fried chicken with a super spicy green chili sambal. And just look at the plate of sambal here. He's mixing up all these green chilies. I feel like calling that a mortar and pestle doesn't do it justice because it's the biggest pestle ever. Penyet kind of means like crushed a little bit, like squeezed. But the geprek, which is another famous one, that's completely smashed chicken. So this is slightly different. And the chili and the sambal mix is a little bit different as well. This one with garlic, right? With garlic, yeah. So we're gonna order some up. He completely
smashes the chicken. You can either order with breast or thigh or whatever cut you want. They also have like eggplant and tofu, different things. And then it's just smeared with that green chili sambal. Very generous amount. I think it's gonna be spicy.
This whole street is just packed with street food stalls, but I had to go for the ayam penyet. It's one of the things I love to try every time here in Indonesia. And this one just looks crazy, the amount of green chili sambal that they put on top of it. Breast meat and thigh as well, and then also eggplant. And gotta eat it with your hands, but luckily they provided some gloves because it's gonna be spicy. Okay, I'm going right in there. Oh my gosh, there's like an inch of chili sambal on top of that. Oh, it's super hot. Try this. Yeah, that is next level spicy. But it's garlicky, it's salty, so it's got tons of flavor in there too. Chicken's crispy, but man, that's got heat to it. Woo, look at how much chili is on this. We've got live music pretty much everywhere here in Indonesia. When you sit down for street food, you got these guys come over, serenade you while you fight the spice. Try out the eggplant. Man, that is seriously spicy. It's not a slow burn, it's an instant burn. That's the type of spice that'll give you like a stomach ulcer. You gotta be careful. If you're not an experienced spice lover, this stuff will blow your head off. Lord, that's spicy. All right, I was just saying that this is borderline almost too spicy for a real Indonesian person right here.
I love spicy, but not that.
This is too spicy?
This is okay.
Almost too spicy?
Almost too spicy.
My tongue is swelling. I can barely speak.
You feel the pain in your tongue? That's too spicy. With too much pain, that's too spicy. It's just a little pain, it's okay.
I'm crying.
I'm still okay. Not me. I'm just sweating.
I'm actually crying. It's so good though. I can't stop. I challenge anybody who thinks they can eat spicy. Come to Indonesia and eat this. I think we need something sweet.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
It's so addicting that I actually ordered thirds, but I ordered this time with no sambal because I had enough extra sambal on the side. I definitely didn't need any more.
Pain and pleasure.
If you guys have been watching this channel long enough, I think you can guess what we're gonna eat next.
Because she offered the goodness, the good stuff.
You know you get
lip fillers. Yeah, and if, can't even talk. Indonesian food, no joke. Like Thai food is spicy, but Indonesian food might be more spicy. They have some dishes that are even more spicy. Vietnamese food, not really spicy. Taiwanese food, obviously Japanese, everything like that's not very spicy. I'd have to say in Asia, Indonesia, India, Thailand are my spiciest countries. So if you couldn't guess it already, it is the best dessert maybe in the world, definitely in Indonesia. One of my favorites for sure. It's martabak manis, sweet martabak. But there's two different kinds. I usually go for the super calorie heavy, like 1,000,000 calorie butter infused thick martabak. But we're gonna try tonight the thin, healthy version of martabak. But I gotta always get it with the cheese and the chocolate. So chocolate sprinkles, they use margarine and butter. And yeah, like this one's a little bit different than the other one. It's thin, crispy, whereas the other one's got thick, saturated, buttery cake. Even though I've probably eaten martabak manis countless times.
Countless times.
I've never had the crispy one.
It's
before.
The first one for you.
First time I've had the crispy.
And the waiting time is like 3 times. Of the
yeah, you have to wait a really long time because they gotta make it super crispy. And they put the cheese on there first so it sort of melts.
Make it all everything crispy, yeah. Make sure everything melted.
Healthy martabak.
Healthy martabak, that's right.
That's right.
At least my volume is still healthier than the normal one.
They didn't cover it in margarine or butter at the end, so.
Oh yeah. Look how crispy and thin.
Oh god.
It's worth the wait, yeah?
So good. Mm.
Oh
you can
God.
Still taste the butter because he did put a dollop of butter
yeah.
in there at the beginning. And it's almost like a crepe.
Like better than any crepes in France.
Not a French crepe. Not a French crepe, like Thailand crepe. They make it crispy like this. Yeah. In France, it's more like a pancake. Like a soft pancake. Oh, it's so good. Cheese and chocolate is the greatest combination for dessert ever. Mark my words, people.
Martabak tipis kering. Mm. Clean and crispy.
Yum. Mm. It's crunch. This, I feel like way less bad after eating it, but I still gotta give it up for the regular thick one.
Less input, but still.
Still delicious.
Still very good.
Yeah, if you're like one person or two people, you might wanna get the crispy one. If you're like 8 to 10 people, get the.
Get both.
Get both, yeah.
Always first time for everything, though. Mm. This one, huh?
Special moment.
Approved. Well, look, Mari.
Look at that, it looks so crispy. Mmm. It's just like a taste of heaven. I like it. Yum.
I like it too.
Just like every other day of my life, starting the day with coffee, but here in Indonesia, Jakarta, Chinatown, that means kopi susu, so coffee with milk in this really old school cafe. Get our energy for the day and then start eating. We're down one of the many alleyways of Jakarta's Chinatown, and we're not sticking strictly with Chinese food today. We have something that's very Indonesian, right?
This is Indonesian, and especially part of Java and also Jakarta.
Okay, and this is called ketoprak.
Ketoprak, yes, correct.
Basically, it starts with a peanut-based sauce that he adds some chili, some garlic, kind of grinds that down, and then the main components are the ketupat, compressed rice cake, and then tofu.
Too. Tofu, that's the most important part.
Yeah, fried tofu.
Fried tofu.
And then it's topped with these noodles, right?
It's vermicelli noodles, some bean sprout, some chopped cucumber, and of course, kerupuk.
Yeah, and a little bit of shallots on top, and you can see this is the real flavor right there. All that peanut sauce at the bottom. Should we try?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, this one is special of this area and also part of Java as well.
It's like a peanut butter. Mm-hmm. Super creamy, but you've got the garlicky-ness in there. You've got a hint of spice. Definitely not too spicy. It just smothers the whole dish in that sauce, though. There's so much of it on the bottom.
And the hint of sweetness from the ketchup manis.
Yes, you put quite a bit of ketchup manis on top of there as well. And the tofu is just awesome. It soaks up the flavor. This is like a really good breakfast dish because, you know, in Canada we like to have like peanut butter toast. This is sort of like Indonesian peanut butter breakfast. I wouldn't say it's toast at all, but.
But sometimes you also put fried egg on top.
Fried egg on top. Oh yeah, that'd be perfect. Yeah, it's good. Another important component that I think we forgot to mention is those bean sprouts in there too. Bean sprouts. And here in Indonesia, you'll have so many dishes with the ketupat, the compressed rice cake. So if you're not familiar with it, you will be once you come to Indonesia.
Mm.
So many subtle variations of dishes here in Indonesia. It gets pretty confusing. That's why I've got this guy with me. Really delicious. That peanut sauce is just so full of flavor and a really humble little push cart stall, but super popular, serving like over 100 plates of that every single morning. One thing that is somewhat unique about Indonesia's Chinatowns is more or less you'll find a mixture of halal and non-halal foods, which you won't really find in other Chinatowns around the world. It's mostly going to be all non-halal foods. So the next dish we have isn't halal. This is a pork noodle dish from a nice gentleman here that has been selling noodles out of this street food cart since 1987. It's just insane. Almost 40 years he's been set up here on the side of the road selling just one dish, one noodle dish, but you gotta master it. If you're selling it for that long, you know it's gonna be good, and this is the final result here. It's a beautiful egg noodle, and what makes it unique is that he's added this water spinach in it. So it's a water spinach pork noodle, so he basically just blanches the egg noodles, and then he tops it with his magical porky soup broth. Let me try some of this out. This is serious street noodles here. It's definitely leaning on the sweet side. I'm surprised at how sweet it actually is, but I love the crunch of the bean sprouts and the water spinach in there, and then those egg noodles are beautiful. It tastes like probably homemade egg noodles, really good quality noodles. It also has a little essence of caviar lime in there as well. Let me try to find a piece of pork here. Try some of the pork. It's just little chopped up bits of pork. Wow, really good. Really good, super satisfying. Since 1987, out of this little streetcar. I love places like this. They just look so unassuming. Your expectations might be a little bit low after maybe seeing the atmosphere, but then once you taste it, it just completely changes your mind. So full of flavor and super cheap too. That was only, I think it was 15 or 20, super cheap. So we've hit pretty much strictly street food stalls. Everyone so far we've gone to today has been serving out of a wooden street cart, wooden or metal street cart, super traditional, old school here in Glodok. And this is something you're also gonna see all over the place here in Indonesia. It's called bakso or baso. It basically just means meatball. So you can see this meatball dish is served with thick noodles here, and there's also some tofu in there. It's a very simple and cheap dish once again, but it is beloved by Indonesians across the country. You can find bakso everywhere. Let's try one of the meatballs. It should have a nice kind of bouncy texture to it. It's not like an Italian meatball or anything that just kind of crumbles in your mouth. This is like a fish ball almost. The texture is really bouncy and the broth is quite salty. Some shallots, some green onions on top. Actually, it's really good. It's really, really good. I love bakso. Let's try some of these noodles. It's super flavorful. A little bit of a spice too. And then we've also got some tofu in there. I love tofu, so good. And the atmosphere here is just so intense. All these narrow little alleyways, it's like a labyrinth here in Chinatown. Motorcycles going by, locals going by, music playing. It's just a feast for all your senses. So we just spotted this couple selling pisang goreng, fried bananas. So he takes a couple bananas that have been cut in half, and I think three pieces at a time, and sort of smashes them together into like a flat banana patty almost, and then fries it up golden crispy, double fried actually, and then this is the result. I love fried bananas, but this one's kind of unique because it's not like the banana shape anymore. It's like a little sort of banana patty. It's nice and sweet, but I love how it stays kind of sour. They use this really ripe bananas. They get a ton of bananas, and it's got that crispy exterior. Oh, fried bananas is really delicious, guys. It's like a dessert and a snack and a meal all in one. It's gotta be healthier than fried chicken, right? It's bananas, so you can eat way more of it. Really tasty pisang goreng, fried bananas, and I have to say I have a really deep respect for street food vendors in general. I mean, it's probably 36 degrees out here. They're selling things for like less than a dollar. They're working all day long,
frying, cooking, whatever they're doing, and sometimes waking up in the middle of the night to start preparations for the day, and just very humble and always super friendly and very welcoming to foreigners like me when I come to try their food. So I just have to say, super respect for these guys.
Yep.
Come to this next little stall that's serving something called soto tengkar, and they've also got sate. They grilled the beef sate right on the charcoal, directly on the charcoal, and the broth of the soup just smells so incredible. It smells like coconut. You got basically a mystery basket of mystery meats, different cuts and
all cuts.
Yeah. What were you telling me about the history of this dish?
Yeah, tengkar came from Dutch colonial era. That time, all the good cuts of meat consumed by the Dutch
went to the Dutch. Yeah.
Yeah, also the local left with trimmings and stuff, including the bones and the innards and stuff. So they have to be creative and make this kind of a lot of spices to actually cover the smell and turmeric and stuff. So make this soto tengkar. Now, of course, mostly beef.
Yeah.
But of course, they still have like feet and innards because we love taste, not because we cannot afford the beef. And they also make the sam sate, the company with the soto. And the broth is very nice because from the turmeric and the coconut milk, very good.
So nowadays we have the opportunity, the pleasure of enjoying the same broth but with the premium cuts of meats, not just for
now we are the Westerners.
The Westerners nowadays. So I ordered just with the meat, the regular cuts of meat. It actually looked like a nice piece of almost brisket.
Of feet there.
maybe a little bit of feet found its way in there. Yeah, I think that's what that is there. And this broth just smells incredible. It reminds me of another dish that Ari and I have had together called soto Betawi.
This is like the close cousin of soto Betawi. A little bit different, the spice. And soto Betawi always uses a mixture of coconut milk and milk. This one only coconut milk.
Oh my god.
How is it?
That broth is crazy. It's full of flavor. Wow. Yum. Really tender beef. And the broth is like
when the fit is so
tangy, little kind of a little bit of a sourness in there. I feel like there's some tomato in there, and chili, and the coconut is just a really strong flavor of coconut. Cooked over charcoal too. And you got some sate. So as Ari was saying, the Dutch colonial period, that's when they would have been eating the good cuts of meat, and it would have been the Betawi people, right? Mm-hmm. Who are the indigenous to this area of Java, who would have had to have the leftovers basically, and then out of that, just like so many other parts in the world, beautiful flavors are born and still preserved to this day.
Yeah, I think that time the leftover for beef and goat goes to the Betawi, and the leftover of pork goes to the Chinese.
Just look at how beautiful that broth is, so flavorful. You can tell this is what they came up with to mask the flavor of anything else, because it's just so powerful. Rich and complex, thick broth. Yum, I could just drink that. Chinatown is just never ending street food. You have so many different things, and it is so packed with people too. This is a really bustling place. The largest Chinatown in Indonesia, and very old, very historic. You can get everything here, not just street food, but you can get, cooking utensils, Chinese New Year stuff, and we're gonna go into this little food court and see what we can find. So we've stumbled into this sort of food court. It's almost like a hawker center actually, and it's right in the heart of Chinatown. We spotted something we want to try. It's another fried fruit, not bananas this time, but fried cempedak, which is a cousin, I guess you could say, of the jackfruit. So
almost like a durian too. It's got a little bit of a durian-ness going on with it. And they fry it into almost like a pancake. Take a couple of different pieces of jempedak, add some batter, and then just fry it in the oil. And then it's served like this with a side of palm sugar syrup. Yeah, like I said, it's almost like a jempedak pancake with the syrup here. You try to go for a little dunk in that. Try that. It's really creamy on the inside. If you've never had jackfruit or jempedak or durian, it's got a little bit of a kind of a smell to it. Not as much as durian does, but it's kind of like a sour, tangy, fruity cream on the inside of a batter, and then with that palm sugar syrup, it's really sweet and good. Let's go for one more dunk in there. Actually, that's really yummy. Yeah, you can taste the jempedak for sure. It's got a unique flavor. I don't know how to explain it. Really tangy. The weather is so hot here in Jakarta, we're starting to lose our minds. We're gonna take a little bit of a break, find some AC, cool off, and digest a little bit. We've eaten so much already. Yeah, that is good though, really good. So we're back out after our break. We've come to have nasi ulam.
Ulam.
And what is it?
Ulam meaning salad.
Salad, okay.
Fresh veggie. So this is like the Betawi rice salad.
Rice salad.
This is like 150 years old dishes.
Okay.
From old time. So they have incorporated Betawi culture, Chinese culture, and also Dutch culture.
Right.
The stew,
yep.
Semur, came from the word, the Dutch word semur.
Okay.
So that time the Dutch only use beef, but the Betawi they put egg, tofu, potatoes,
okay, yeah.
And then all the crunchiness.
Yeah, from those crackers.
Yes, crackers.
As
and
usual.
The lalap meaning the fresh veggie,
yeah.
And some pounded peanuts. That's
peanuts,
the
yeah.
Oriental part.
So you pick all your different toppings.
Yeah.
We had like a bunch of different things to select,
beef jerky.
But I went with beef jerky,
dendeng,
this right here, and then also went with tofu and an omelet somewhere hiding
yeah,
in there.
Here.
There is rice underneath all of that. It's kind of hard to see, but yeah, very similar to what we had this morning, but different flavors. Look similar because everything's just topped with the keropok, the crackers here. But let's try.
And then they pour the broth, yeah? The broth made from
jerky. It's got a nice kind of chewiness. The rice is completely smothered in that broth with the Dutch influence. What kind of Dutch influence are we talking here?
So the dish is smor. It's like a Dutch stew. But here we put edamames, we put cinnamon, we put cloves, so many other spices added to the smor. It's like a braised beef
right.
Supposed to be. But
oh,
here we use cheaper ingredients like tofu, like egg, like potatoes.
It's really full of flavor. You can see it just has soaked the rice. It's like a stew of rice almost down there. And then with those fresh herbs on top, what is that? It's like a lemon basil?
Yeah, lemon basil.
Lemon basil, yeah.
Daun kemang.
Yeah. Really interesting here in Indonesia, they mix rice and noodles together in one dish. I don't know if I've ever seen that anywhere else before. Interesting. So always keep your eye out on the table in Indonesia. There's gonna be some sort of sambal, spicy sauce. Put some on this omelet here and try that. This is really, really good actually. Super satisfying, full of flavor. Yeah, it gives it some heat. I love that lemon basil in there, it's so fresh though. So far today we've had pretty much exclusively street food, I think. Like no one has had an actual restaurant, just a little stall on the side of the road. Even that guy wasn't there earlier when we walked past this part of town. He just rolled up and he's just selling his nasi ulam now. We're heading for something a little bit more Chinese next, some bakmi, some noodles.
I've got my bowl of bakmi, some noodles, meat noodles, this chicken noodles, and just a little bit of green. Super simple. Let's try.
That's good. It's like a dry noodle though, because you serve the soup on the side, so you can just kind of let some of that soup in there because it's kind of salty. And also, get some of this mystery sambal. Add that generously. Let's see if that gives it a little bit more flavor. I'm sure it will. It's super salty. Simple bowl of noodles. You can find bakmi all throughout Chinatown. It's one of the top things you've got to try. This one's good, but maybe not my favorite.
Not the best bakmi I've ever had, but that's okay. We've been on a pretty good roll today, so it's pretty reasonable to have one that's not top notch. I'm gonna take you to probably my favorite place in Glodok, in Chinatown, for fried dumplings. I've actually filmed it before, but since we're here, I figured we might as well go have some. Legendary here in Chinatown. It's called Santong Kuotie 68. And like I said, I've been here before. Things look to be pretty much the same, except they didn't have a monkey chained up out front the last time I was here. Kind of sad to see that, to be honest, but the dumplings here are legendary. They fry them in a flame. They're flaming dumplings. So kuotie, they're kind of like pot stickers or gyoza. And I've got a plate of 10 of them here. And then the sauce, he just came over and actually made the sauce up for me. It's like a chili with sesame oil and garlic. And these are probably gonna be burning hot, but let's try one anyway. These are some of the best dumplings ever. So juicy. They've got, I think, a little bit of bean sprout in there, because it's got a bit of a crunch too. And they're making them up fresh constantly, just constantly making batches of them and then frying them in a ton of oil. They're quite greasy, definitely. But wow, it goes so good with this sauce. A little garlicky, yum. Yum. Just as good as I remember them being. You get a little crunch on the bottom, but they still got all that juice contained inside. Yeah. This is probably my number one pick here in Chinatown for non-halal. We had a good mix of both today. Obviously, these are filled with pork. Really good. For our first barbecue of the day, we are having beef ribs, and a good sign of any barbecue is billowing smoke coming from the restaurant, and this place certainly doesn't have any shortage of smoke. They have this massive grill of these huge ribs, and they're just completely painting it in sambal. So he's actually got a paintbrush and tongs, because the paintbrush is so covered in the sambal that he's using the tongs to hold the paintbrush and paint all of those ribs. Super, super smoky, and they've got a couple different flavors. We're gonna order up a bunch of different things to try, but just check out this grill. All charcoal, of course, the way it should be.
Apparently now I'm just gonna spend the rest of my life here working at the barbecue restaurant, flipping ribs. No complaints. Look how good these ribs look. It's hot back here.
So Ari and I are sitting down now. We've ordered all three different flavors that they sell. Is this like Indonesian style, or is it like Western style?
It's just like a
fusion
mixture.
Yeah, this is original, and then we got black pepper. Look at how much black pepper is on top of it.
This is a lemon and hot
lemon
sambal.
Yeah, sambal, lemon sambal, and then served with some chips on the side. And just like, look at the size of one of these ribs. That is like a monster beef rib. Super smoky. The restaurant's super smoky. What do you want to try first?
This one first.
Pepper?
Yes.
All right.
Yeah, I like black pepper.
Super tender, super smoky, just falls off the bone. This is a mouthful of beef rib. Yeah.
Okay, this one is lemon hot.
Completely coated, smothered in sauce. Look at the size of that rib. That's like as big as my head. That's crazy. And there's a lot of meat on them too. Let me try this. It's lemon hot.
Yeah, it's hot. Mm. A little bit hot.
I'd say this is a little bit kind of westernized with the sauce, the flavoring. It's definitely not a pretty thing to eat. I probably have sauce all over my face. I know Ari does. Don't wear any white here.
Usually in Indonesian style, we are more into ketchup manis glaze. Mm. And then we eat it with a lot of sweet soy sauce, mm-hmm. and chili and stuff.
Oh my gosh.
This is like a fusion.
Okay, last but certainly not least, this is their original flavor. So this is probably just the sambal that they were painting it on the grill on. There. Yeah.
They use the actual paint brush.
They do, yeah. The texture of the meat, it's just so soft, melt in your mouth, and super smoky too. And we're going for a lot of barbecues today. This is just our first stop on our little barbecue tour here in Jakarta.
I feel like this is the most satisfying barbecue I ever tasted in Indonesia, because not only that extra salt with the big brush they put on the barbecue, but you eat this by hand. Mmm, so good.
Bigger than your head too.
Look at that sauciness. So much sauce.
Your favorite flavor?
I think I like the black pepper.
What's your favorite flavor?
Lemon hot.
Lemon hot? Well, I'll go original then.
That place is a meat lover's paradise. Seriously delicious beef ribs. Thank you. We're heading straight to our next location for ikan bakar, grilled seafood. We have made it to the grilled fish restaurant just in time. It started pouring rain. I hope you can hear me okay. It's really loud. It's coming down like crazy in here. And they've got another charcoal grill here. This is a Sulawesi restaurant. So from the eastern part of Indonesia, an island called Sulawesi, they actually air fly all the seafood in here. So they've got buckets of fresh seafood that's just been flown in from Sulawesi. And they do it a little bit different style. Again, he's got a paintbrush and he's topping it with that sambal, painting it on. This sambal is a little bit different though. It's a green sambal. It's gonna be a lot spicier, I know it, because this is a Sulawesi restaurant, a real local spot. And we ordered up one fish, a decent sized fish. I'm not totally sure what kind it is. I'll have to ask Ari, but just so smoky, this grill. Once again, crazy grills here in Indonesia.
Before we dig the fish, we should make some concoction from the sambal.
Okay, yeah, we've got these three different types of sambal.
Yeah, this is, we call it sambal petis, made from fermented shrimp paste.
Okay, shrimp paste sambal.
Yeah, and okay. Then this is the rica iris. That's the
okay,
sambal.
So I see some slice. Tomatoes in there, yeah, as well.
Tomatoes and some chili and lemon basil. We got raja mangga, which is like the shredded mango, green mango. So based on your liking, truly you just mix everything.
Okay. Can I steal some of yours?
Sure.
I'm gonna steal some of yours instead.
Yeah.
We're going with our fingers?
Sure.
All right, let's
maybe
go right in.
Maybe take the flesh with the rica sauce first before we dig into sambal.
Oh, it's hot. So it's just some of the natural.
The original
rica flavor? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, let's try that.
Is it?
Yeah. Wow. That fish is really good.
The fish is really
good. Perfectly, right? Yeah. It's not like overcooked, it's not dried out, it's still nice and juicy. Yep, that's spicy, but I think I got mostly just the tomato in that bite, which is kind of a soothing, refreshing, less spicy. Oh yeah, look at that. There's some chili on there. Get those bones out of there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh.
The spiciness getting thin, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now we can
immediate.
Mix it with the sambal.
Okay, yeah.
So many flavors here. You get the tartness and sourness from the mango.
Yeah.
Semi pungent dip from the pate sauce, the shrimp paste sauce.
Shrimp paste, yeah. Okay, let me try this one. Really
so this is Southern Sulawesi style ikan bakar.
Southern Sulawesi.
Mana Makassar or Ujung Pandang, the name of the restaurant.
That's the crazy thing about Indonesia is there's so many islands, so many huge islands, such a massive country, long country, that even you've probably never heard of Sulawesi food. Well, I'm just learning now there's a northern and a southern Sulawesi food. So again, that's why I got Ari here.
The whole Sulawesi, they love fish.
Right.
And then they love fresh fish, So they are flown this all kind of fish from Eastern Indonesia to Jakarta.
Wow, with this sambal mixture is so good. That like that mango.
Yeah.
It's got a nice crunch to it, a little sour.
I like the mango. We call it racha manga.
Actually, that's a lot less spicy than just the sambal that's on top of there.
Yes, because we get the sweetness from the shrimp paste.
Yeah, that's really good fish. Amazing.
This is such a staple in Sulawesi or Southern Sulawesi culture. Maybe the family there, you can eat 3 to 4 times a week for ikan bakar.
Really?
Some maybe daily.
Wow. So this is the Sulawesi staple, huh?
Sulawesi staple.
Yeah. Oh man, there's so much flavor in that topping. I mean, they rubbed it with a little bit of a green sambal, but then whatever they put on top here, this mixture of chilies and green tomatoes and the lemon basil too. It's just so full of flavor. It is spicy. How am I doing with my hands? I feel like over the years I've improved.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah?
Yeah. So this is like one, and then you push it with your thumb.
Yeah, you gotta get that thumb
this
action
scoop,
right here.
And this is your...
Right. And scoop it in.
Perfect.
It's an acquired skill. Perfect. Chopstick travel, still mastering that.
No bare hand travel.
Bare hand travel, yeah. Gotta do it like the locals here in Indonesia.
Tomatoes. Oh, really? Oh, spicy. That's two chilies color right here. The orange and the red one. And once I get my fish, I took the red one outside, but I eat the orange one. And you know what? Turns out that Ari said the spicy one is the orange one, so I ate it all. It's so spicy. Like, I feel like I'm gonna cry.
Don't wipe your eyes, careful.
Oh my god, yeah, you're right.
Sulawesi definitely spicy.
Yeah.
Spicier than Thai.
Spicier
than Thai. Not Java.
Not Java.
Sulawesi?
Yeah.
Yes.
Woo-wee. What do you think, Thai person? Spicier than Thai food? In general, maybe not,
but like the chili that they use cook in the food here, it's like,
yeah,
it's like in your body. Woo. It's so good though, it's like really good.
You know the island called Lombok, just east of Bali?
Oh yeah, yeah.
The island
Lombok
means chili.
Means chili island.
Means chili, that's one of the hottest too.
Oh wow, we gotta go there. Chili island.
Chili island.
That's just like intense, fiery, spicy, like burn underneath your eyes and just start sweating, but so delicious and addicting. And like Ming said, you want to not stop eating it, because when you stop eating it, it burns, so you just keep eating and keep eating. We got another barbecue, so let's go.
Okay, yeah. Wah, lama kuri.
So remember when I said a sign of a good barbecue is you gotta see the smoke billowing out the front of the shop? Well, this is definitely the smokiest shop yet. I am just being bathed in the smoke. So this is traditional Indonesian sate. Everybody knows it, everybody loves it. So they've got kambing, which is beef, and then ayam, which is chicken. And they've got two stations, both on charcoal, of course. They've got it pretty much directly on the charcoal. And then they've got the hand fan. That's always better than when they use the electric fan, just because it's more traditional, the bamboo woven fan. And we're gonna order up a little bit of both the beef and the chicken. I definitely need a shower after this, because I am gonna smell like smoke until I shower. This place is so ridiculously smoky that everything in proximity of it has been completely covered in soot. like this pole right here. It looks like it's a black pole, but you can actually see it used to be green like this, and now it's completely turned black from the smoke of the sate. This is the smokiest spot so far, by far. Woo! So I've got my sate here covered in all kinds of ketchup manisa, sweet dark soy sauce, and then they put some, looks like fried shallots on top, some onions, some green chili, some tomato, and this entire restaurant is just full of smoke. Like, I can't believe they're not wearing masks working there. Not only are they breathing in all that smoke all day, they're also smoking cigarettes at the exact same time. Honestly, how do they even have any oxygen going into their lungs? I do not know, but this is a very famous sate place. And Ari was just telling me that the people that run this place are from an island called Madura, which is east of Java, and there's not a lot of opportunity in Madura, so a lot of the people there moved to bigger cities like Jakarta, and then they built up a reputation for selling, in particular, sate, but just being known as being really good chefs, but they're really famous for their sate. Oh my god, yeah. Oh, yum. They've got it like a piece of meat, and then a piece of fat, and then a piece of meat, so that fat completely just melts in your mouth, but it also sort of drips down onto the rest of the meat and kind of cooks it and gets all that fat kind of infused into the meat. The flavor is just coated in ketchup anise though. Like, it's really sweet from that ketchup anise charoma. I can't even say that it's smoky because all I can smell, see, and taste is smoke right now. Everything is smoky here. Yum. Really tender and good though, yum.
Oh, the sauce, they got, they're sweet. They got more customer coming, so they have to grill more sate, so the smoke is like, it's like it disappeared in the mist.
So next up is the chicken sate ayam, and this is a totally different sauce on here. So no ketchup manis, this is the peanut sate sauce. Let's try one of these.
Mm. Oh my gosh. Wow.
That's crazy how soft the chicken is. It's even more tender than the beef actually. Completely falls apart. Effortless chewing from that peanut sauce. It's so full of flavor. So creamy and rich. I don't know if this is controversial, what I'm about to say, but I think sate is, you know, it's found everywhere in the world, but it's really an Indonesian thing. When you come to Indonesia, you can find sate all across the country on all the islands. They all do it a little bit differently, but I think, you know, sate is definitely one of the most popular, most famous Indonesian foods. And this one comes also with the lontong, the compressed rice. At the bottom, kind of soak up all that extra peanut sauce. Yeah. Look how beautiful that is. Ugly delicious. Yum.
Normally, as like the famous restaurant, people are gonna say it worth the wait, but at this famous place, I'm gonna say it worth the smoke.
Out of all the three barbecues that we had today, Ming, what was your favorite? The beef ribs, the ikan bakar, the fish, or the classic sate?
I think I like the ikan bakar, the fish, because not only you taste the smokiness from the fish, but also you add more like complex and like tasty taste from the sauce. And I really like the shrimp taste, that the sauce and then like the spiciness from a lot of chilies on top of it. I feel like that's like a perfect combination of everything together. Yeah, what about you?
For me, maybe it's my Western palate, but I gotta give it up for the beef ribs. I think the beef ribs are the best.
Fish, sate, ribs.
Really? Ribs number three, huh?
Maybe because it's in my Indonesian palate.
Great sate, but man, I couldn't wait to finish eating in there just so I could breathe some fresh air again. All right, that's it for our barbecue tour, but let's go get a dessert to wrap up the day.
So to cool off after our day of eating barbecue, we've come to have a shaved ice dessert called Ice Talaire. And she has the coolest ice shaving machine. It's like a hand crank to shave the ice. And then she's topped it with avocado, some coconut, some jackfruit, condensed milk, some sauces, all kinds of different things. She really went crazy with all the ingredients. Let me dig into this and get a little bit of everything if I can. I love that there's fresh avocado in there. And I am a strong believer that avocado, it's also a great dessert ingredient, not just for savory dishes like we have in the West. Yeah. Oh, it's sweet. Very cold. Oh, super refreshing. Let me get a little bit of jackfruit on top. Such an awesome ingredient too, the jackfruit. Oh, yum. Avocado is super creamy. Wow. It's a crazy combination of flavors and ingredients. If we made this in Canada, and if we had jackfruit and fresh coconut and great avocados, we put them all on there, but I feel like it's a bit of a sin to cover it in the sweet condensed milk because it sort of masks the flavors of the fruit, but it does work. It's good.
So the name meaning drunken ice.
Teller.
Drunken is like drunk.
Oh.
As teller.
Why?
Well, this is a long time ago in Indonesia. They have like a contest to make the best ice dessert. And the one that have the recipe called the ice drunken ice. And they won. But many people actually also steal the recipe and then selling this kind of ice dessert. Mm. So the real copyright owner is another brand, but a lot of brands now selling Estella all over Indonesia.
Mm. So was he drunk when he made it or something?
Mm. Most probably.
Probably?
Yeah.
I probably drunk when I eat this, drunk by the smokiness. Oh, super refreshing.